Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. That's the normal intro out of the way. He's back by popular demand.
I don't know about popular. I think just pushing it a little bit.
Well,
a handful of people, maybe.
Well, for a fun fact for everyone, of the top five audio editions of the SWN podcast, the top five, two of them are your episodes.
Oh wow!
Oh. So it's by popular demand. People want to hear more about Scotty Swift, or maybe just want to hear you, very people.
No one wants to know about me, but they want to hear me talk about other people. That's what the boys want me to do. So, and I have started drinking. So we'll see.
I have also, but like I said, just off here, it is Bud Lights, so they don't really count, apparently. That's half a beer. It's fine, it's nice, it's refreshing, and it's like 22 degrees here, so I need all the refreshment I can get at this point.
I've got my water bottle filled with rum and coke, so I'm ready.
That's an athlete's drink there, with the old sports cap.
Well, why am I drinking it?
Right, so it's... Oh, sorry, yeah.
How are you?
Nobody really asks me. I'm all right, actually. Yeah, I'm fine. I'm not... I was going to say I'm tired, but I'm not really tired. I'm just hot at the moment. Not just physically, but because it's really hot here. And as a chubby fella, it's... If I had hair, it would be like just all over the place at the moment because I'm just so warm. Open a window and an ice cream van will arrive at some point, so I can't really do that too much. I don't want to open the door because then Kelly will have to be subjected to my half of the conversation, which isn't the bit that interests folk really. So it's just a very warm time. How are you doing?
I'm fine. Not much to report apart from, again, I mean, we'll get into all the wrestling going on, the wrestling. I mean, I'm now over the fact that I missed the Raw. I'm lying, actually. I'm not over missing the Rumble. I don't think I ever will be over missing the Rumble. I had a real, real difficult time that day dealing with not being there. And heaps of people messaging me. People not like, obviously, Aston was traveling in for the show. And I said, oh, by the way, I won't see you today. That's me, got COVID. He's like, hi, what? Like, no, really, I'm not going to be there. The idea of me not being there just, like, blew his mind. Like, what do you mean you're not going to be there? Like, I've got COVID. He's like, fuck's sake, yes. Fucking raging.
He's bear weather fans, eh? And they come into every show. Shocking.
I'm not loyal to the cause. I dealt with not being there by very aggressively hoovering the house.
So your house was spotless. That's pretty much the amount of it.
I was raging, but the carpets looked immaculate, so at least I had that going for me. So getting back for the Academy show and being there for Anarchy was good, but missing the Rumble was tough, really tough.
I'm sure you've maybe seen the footage back, but I think I was beside myself. But for the whole Rumble, I was just in a state the whole time.
You and Kyle were, and Kyle illegally injecting himself into the proceedings, and it's like, you know, you're not a wrestler, Kyle. You trained for a little bit. You came for 1 week, and then you fucked off again, mate. We've never really spoken about that. We will one fucking day. Him getting involved, and that's called being invested. That's what we do. Personal investment is what we do in the Northeast. So I just wish I was there for it. But I managed to watch the show back fairly quickly afterwards. I had the chance to watch it, but whenever I got the link to watch stuff back, and then I sat in it for about 10 hours because it still hurt. It's still not like I really wanted to see it, but I wasn't ready to click on that link straight away. So I waited half a day, and then I was like, "Let's get and watch it." Thoroughly enjoyed it, but it was a kick in the teeth.
No, the investment thing, absolutely. That's what's, well, for me, that's what it's all about. And my wee mental breakdown in my car after Aberdeen Anarchy and all that kind of stuff. And it's just, yeah, it was It was good fun, but we'll get to that. We'll kind of do a little bit of a timeline thing. I'm kind of organized now. I mean, looking at the last time we spoke, I said episode 159 is this one. It was episode 22 and 27, and then we did round about Christmas time. We did the behind the match thing with Super Executioner. There was a third one, and I haven't written down the date for that, and I can't remember what it was, but it must have been season 3.
Yeah,
August. August 30th came out. So
surely there's nothing else for us to talk about.
You would think so.
Yeah, surely there's nothing else.
Okay. But there's loads of questions that have come in.
Sure,
so
there can't be it.
We'll find stuff. We'll find stuff. I am aware for everyone listening that for some reason Elgin just hates internet. We're not really used to it. Light is still a bit scary thing for us. So my audio might dip in and out. It's just a thing, unfortunately. So at least hopefully we'll get a whole episode. I had a run of like five where my internet just cut out entirely. So we'll touch wood. All the wood, we're good. Right, we're gonna push on through. But yeah, so there's.
I mean you're just Elgin. It's not like you're in the wood somewhere. I mean, you are in a. I mean, Elgin should have internet by now. That's decent. Really, I mean, let's be honest. Elgin should.
You would think so, but like Falkenburg is an absolute dump, and it's 5 miles up the road, and it's got like fiber and all that kind of stuff. It's got all the fancy shit.
Uh-oh.
But nothing here. But it's a prayer. You really just have to pray, and it works most of the time. it's awful, but it generally it's fine. It's like the old dial up. It seems to be if there's too many people that are browsing internet at a certain time, it seems to just absolutely die. I don't know what everyone's doing at around about 7 o'clock and 9 o'clock most evenings, but that's generally the times where it goes, no, you're not allowed to watch this, whatever it is, you're not allowed to do this. So I don't know what Elgin people do at 7 o'clock and nine. That's their own business.
Just watch The Office and that's fine.
Yeah, absolutely. Nothing seedy at all.
Wink, wink, Elgin.
So, since we last chat, since we last chat, the shows did come back because we had a chat before, after Halloween Hijinks. So we already kind of covered what was it like getting crowds back, etc. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So you can go back and listen to the Super Executioner episode behind the match if anyone wants to find out about that. But since then, we had the new year came around, shows back in full swing. I think just about all of them, if not just about, just about all of them sold out as well. So besides the Rumble, what's it been like just getting these run of shows back going and getting in front of folk again?
It's been really encouraging. I think we spoke about this before, or maybe it was me and Vago that spoke about it during the whole lockdowns and kind of hoping that we would come back and people would be so happy that there's wrestling back on that we would be busy, but then also the uncertainty of what if, you know, some people like are away from it for a wee while and don't think about it again. What if people don't want to go out because they're worried, and, you know, they were like, it's in their heads now, is it safe? And luckily what's happened is everyone's just happy that not just wrestling but everything's back. And every show has been either, like you said, either sold out or close to it, or like standing room only. And that makes a huge difference. If Summer Hill would have been better than it was if we still had those restrictions, you know, they came back for a couple of weeks, which was just okay. Then they were lifted on the Monday and the show was on the Saturday. So, of course, we missed it by 2 days. So, and that was a really good show that I had a lot of fun in that show because I just had a fight. Me and Omar just had a fight with two boys and it was great fun.
that was absolutely wild. As I get older now, I literally this is making me sound so old, but when of course the sandwich board got broken at some point over someone's head, I can't remember whose, probably Omar's. He got quite a lot.
No, Omar.
Right. So yeah, that happened, and my first thought, as a very old man, I turned to Kelly. I went, oh, I hope they've got liability insurance or event insurance or something, because, you know. And then I took myself for a minute, going, oh, Jesus, how fucking old am I? Let's just not go watching the wrestling. So yeah, it was yeah, that was wild. That was absolutely a blast. That whole show, I've said in other things that seemed to be kind of not your over 18s kind of thing, but it was a bit rougher, a bit more wilder than you would usually expect from a wrestling show.
Well, there was one moment that could have been classified as over 18s, and that was a mistake, and we'll talk about that later on, because a question has been asked about this person, or this person has asked a question, so that'll come up. I think a part of it was starting the show off the way you want to consume it, you know, starting off with a strong show. It's always nice to announce with the start of the year, and just, oh, we're back with a bang. And I just love a scrap. I am weird. I know I'm weird. I don't enjoy getting hurt, but I don't have as big a problem with it as I probably should have. So when matches tend to get a little bit wilder, a little bit, you know, out there, like, I do enjoy them. I do them all the time. I also don't want to step on Vago's toes too much, because Vago's a brawler now, and I get that. But I do enjoy when, you know, okay, we're not going to get in the ring, and we're not going to tie up and take the headlock and then send a guy. No, we're going to have a scrap tonight, and that's just the way it is. And they are fun. But so I think that was, everyone was kind of just wanting to start 2022 strong. And I think we did. And it was a nice start, nice build to the Rumble, which ironically I missed, but that's what that was there for. Damien and Zach was the main event. Well, that's going to be good. There's no doubt that's going to be a hell of a match, and it was. And then your boy came back and you almost had a heart attack, so that's good. yeah. You know, when, you know, the lights go off and there's Aspen, it's like, here it comes. And, like, you know, you, Kyle, and Mark are all, you know, floating, basically levitating at this point. Making moments again, because we spoke about making moments, and moments being what it's about, you know, and having the chance to make more moments. So you said that after we come back from the lockdown, what do you want to do? Well, I want to make moments. And that's a moment, you know. So I was very happy with that show. Very happy. I just wish we could have got more people in, because as it was, we had restrictions, and that show deserved to be seen by more people. But what can you do?
That's the thing. I think you can go back to every show I've been to, or all the rest of those shows I've been to since the show's returned. Because of course I missed two. I didn't go to the Academies either. So or Gala Days, but I missed one. I could probably pick out maybe two or three. Three at the very least moments during the show that you can go back to and go, oh, this was part of this. This is the reason why this happened. Like your match with the outfit, you know, Omar at Summerhill, that made entire. There's a grudge match. You're not going to go, right, we're going to have a wee lock up and then we're going to roll about a bit and then we'll do. No, there's no sense to that. That is not the point of the whole grudge, the feud kind of thing. So I love. This will be a lot of, again, this is my podcast deal. If you mention WrestleZone, I'll just like go, it's the best thing ever. But like, everything makes sense. It's just logic, and I like it. I like logical booking. It makes sense to me, and that's what probably makes it even more easy to invest in as well. Because I'm like, of course they're not going to do some grappling bits. They're going to fight.
It's like when shows do things that take people out of it, and those people have been taken out of it, and those people may not be able to maybe articulate why they're taken out of it. Some people can, like people like yourself could maybe articulate. Some people who don't look at it the way that you do couldn't. But the feeling is the same, is something's right here and I don't know why. Mm-hmm. And when something isn't quite right and you're not into it, you can tell that a crowd will flatten out a little bit. And you just know. And sometimes it's part of a bigger story. Maybe it isn't about tonight, you know, but it isn't just about what's happening here. It's maybe what's happening here is going to end up being something further on down the line, and then you go, it's a whole. Sometimes not everything makes sense on the night, but we get there.
Yeah,
I mean, I agree with you. But,
pick us something. We'll get into the weeds of it, but for example, for that, for me in wrestling's venue, it was Brian Tucker. Because I didn't get it. It took me a couple matches for me to actually. Well, I think I got it. I don't know if I've just made up something, but of his kind of like gatekeepery status kind of thing. He's the kind of standard that the new guys have to come up against kind of thing. And it that's how I perceived it. Eventually, it took me a couple goes of going, this guy's a bit of a knob. And then eventually, I was like, oh, he's getting all the new guys coming in. That's why he's the standard. He's the guy you have to go through to go to the next stage. It makes sense now. But yeah, like I said, I could just totally make it up because I like doing that. If anyone's read anything I've done fantasy booking wise, I've like made a mountain out of this tiny little molehill that happens.
But no, I think it's nice. I think it's nice that you're.
I'm still here. It's
yeah,
been weird.
Like I like the. Yeah, I like the fact that you're picking up on a theory that it's like, you know, when you're watching a movie, and something can be a little bit ambiguous, and people have their own theories and take away from it. I think it's cool that there's something on one of our shows that people are doing that with. It is almost like a movie. It's like. There's enough depth to what's going on that someone could and they might not be necessarily right, but their theory does have some credence behind it because that makes sense to them, and I think people forget that Brian's been around as long as almost I have, you know, maybe like a year or two after. I mean, like myself, Volume, Alan, Damien, Crusher, who unfortunately now has hung the boots up, and as that may get spoken about today as well. Mr. P's been around, so Sean Johnson's been here. It's like, Tucker's been around for as long as almost everyone. Can I almost take it for granted a little bit? Like, he's solid and he's good for it. But the guy's a former undisputed champion. He's won the Rumble. He's like a 5-time tag team champion. I mean, pretty much done everything. When the Tri-County Championship was about to become a thing, he was one of the four guys who was chasing it. He's done everything. And I think people just take it for granted. They kind of just forget about him. And I think Tucker is just maybe his way of reminding people that I may be a pain in the arse, but I'm your pain in the arse because I've been here as long as everyone else has. Thank you very much. So, I like your interpretation of it. I do like that. I'm not going to say whether I think that's right or agree with it, but I do like the way you've interpreted it. And people can interpret the same thing in different ways, and that's what I like about it. I mean, there's layers to, you know, there's definitely layers, and that goes back to having that investment and. It's like a good movie. People can take like a good movie. You take from it what you put into it. That's what you take away. And I think a good wrestling show is the same, or a good wrestling story is the same.
Absolutely. Speaking of investment, then, so since the show has restarted, of course, there seems to be the social media buzz is a little bit higher now for WrestleZone. It's mainly because there's three podcasts now covering it. Of course, we still write about it as well through Adam. And it must be kind of, I don't know, what's the word? I can't think of the word, but it must be good. That's the equivalent word. Must be good to hear all this kind of feedback so quickly nowadays.
Yeah, obviously you've been covering us for a long time now, but and I'm not going to speak too much about the whole deal, but I've spoken to me before and it's been overlooked and ignored. I've really kind of mentioned it before. And it's good because, I mean, you're not all net. I mean, obviously there's certain things that are clearly everyone's going to like this because there's some things, I mean, we speak about, and I'm sure it'll come up, but I, for my money, the main event of Anarchy this year is the greatest match in the history of the company, in my opinion. And I told the guys that after the fact. and Aston didn't blame me. And I said, no, well, it was. So, and I said that if I'd been in that match, halfway through that match, I'd have just been going home because fuck that. There's not a fucking chance I'd manage it. There's absolutely, without any doubt, Aspen, Damien, and Zach are three of the best, and it's three of the best in the UK, and that's a fucking fact. And that's a fucking fact. And that match proved it. And all you guys are gonna have the same. Kind of opinion on it. It's like you're all gonna like that match because it was fucking incredible.
Mm-hmm.
But there's little things that like you pick up in some things that other guys don't pick up on. But Adam's very analytical, so he picks up in things that you wouldn't pick up on. So we're getting like similar opinions, but then every now and then there's a wee change and. How all your brains are wired, and then you pick up in different things. Again, not saying that I agree with your theories or agree with what you're saying, but I love the fact that you're all taking different things from it. It's still unusual having people out with us give a fuck. It's nice. It's nice to be appreciated. It's nice to be recognised, and thank you very much for that. But, I mean, whether this was happening or not, we would still be doing what we're doing. And we'd be continuing to do that for years without the recognition of other people. Again, people vote with their wallets. And I, in my gauge, it's my eyes and ears. I can see it and I can hear it. And that's the only barometers I need, really.
Mm-hmm.
Because you'll know when something's good, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Because I can see it and I can hear it, you know. And I can't be swayed from having it because it's right there. It's tangible. It's real. I'm getting this instant feedback. I know if something's good. Same if I'm not in there and I'm just watching it. It's like I know I can tell if it's going well because I can see it and I can hear it, you know. And you can't fuck with that grading system, you know. For us and for our crowds, what we're doing is working. Like I said before, not every single time will it be perfect. I do think this year's Anarchy might have been the best show we've done ever. I've had a few people say that, and I can't argue it. But that the main event of Anarchy is absolutely the best match ever in that venue. It's probably the best match in company history.
I mean, I think I put it on Twitter. I was saying that it's amazing that the same person's in probably my two absolute favorite matches that were in the ballroom, because their one was Damien and Tyler Bate was my other one. I would say is probably was maybe just between that and a Bingo Balance Stevie Boy at the first Anarchy in the Beach Ballroom. That's probably like that was my top two, and then this triple threat just came in and went, nah, fuck you guys, we're gonna go to the top. And you guys can fight for second a little bit.
You know, I mean, for me, the two matches that you mentioned, the other two matches that you mentioned there, were they existed to be good matches.
Mm-hmm.
Like they almost existed in their own little world as here's an exhibition of guys who are really talented. Well, the triple threat was the culmination of years of history, and that's the difference.
Mm-hmm.
That's the difference. And right from a little things like Damien came out to different music, the whole vibe in that room changes now. The whole vibe changes. Before those three guys have even touched each other, he came out, and without saying it, he's saying, I think this might be my end in top. Mm-hmm. He's acknowledging the fact that this night is different. It's bigger than any other night. And those three guys did it without it being 1,000 people in the ballroom. That's how you do it. And that's how you do it, having little things like that before the bell even rings. And the energy, I wasn't in the room at the time, but I was close enough to feel the energy in that building change. And it totally changed. And then they went out and they totally fucking killed it. Which I knew they would. I was never any doubt. it was, I mean, I was speaking about it being the biggest match of company history. And it's always a thing, yeah, but you know, it's not the beach ballroom. But then by the time we got to bell time, everyone kind of had bought into that. And then he delivered it. So it was fucking incredible. Mm. It's so fucking good. I'm just glad that no one died. This pretty wild shit. Aspen was beaten to fuck afterwards. Elbow was a nice. His elbow was double the size it should be. But they were bound and determined to live up to the hype, and they did. So, and this wasn't just Aspen came back in January in a 5 month build. It wasn't that, because like Zach's been in the cusp of being the guy forever. It's like Aspen would have been the guy, but then you know circumstances changed, and then COVID happened, and Damien's been champion for so long. I think, God, is he ever going to not be champion? It's just like, is that belt just glued to him now? You know, it wasn't a 5 month build. It was like a 10 year culmination,
mm-hmm.
And that shit. Sorry for being graphic. That shit gets me hard, Billy. That shit gets me fucking hard, and it does. Right? I'm sorry, but it does, because you can't get to that point until you set yourself up in such a way that your company can exist for long enough to tell these stories. When companies pop up and disappear again, yeah, like you can't make your match feel like it's the biggest thing ever because you haven't been around long enough to get people to believe in it being a big deal. Mm-hmm. You know, you need to be able to be around for about 10 plus years to be able to do that in the first place. That's why I don't like most kind of promotions won't always be able to do that, because they haven't been around long enough doing things as best as they can to get to the point where you can tell these stories.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think it was a culmination of 10 years, and it was fucking AIDS. And I was so glad that I wasn't in the match, because I'd have fucked it.
I'm just glad
it was those three, because those three...
even the things that... Fucking internet. Even the things that were kind of not supposed to happen, like I say, it was so tense and not showing it. And the fact that everyone was still up for the main event after all the matches, because it was a big show, because it was 10 matches in total. So they had 9 matches, well, 8 matches in a segment beforehand. But then we had main event, and then Martin's microphone didn't work, and he just threw it to the ground. And I was like, Jesus, this is so tense that he's just like, going, fuck, this needs to happen, this needs to start now kind of thing, this needs to fucking happen. It's just like, yeah, everything I said it in the road trip episode, I think, probably. I haven't watched that particular segment back, because I'm like, I kind of watch myself have a wee emotional greet in my car with a pizza next to me, wanting to get home to see the Eurovision results. So I'm just like, yeah, it was such a culmination, like you're saying. I mean, it's still impressive that even 2019, the main event had a 28-day build or something like that. It was still emotional. It's still emotive and still had all that kind of thing. But yeah, when you add another 10 years on it as well, it's just, yeah, I always love, like I say, I'm interpreting stories that may not necessarily be there, but I like to think I've tackled it with enough logic that I can feel still invested in it. Like, I think it was Damien Sean. I think I did an essay about, oh, this started this point, but it actually started at this point a couple of years before, or started at this point, which is like 6 months after that. And like, but, and then possibly you guys are going, right, we're going to build from here to there. We've got some stuff as well that we could pull into if we need to. And then if you've got this dork going, oh, this started 3 years ago, and you're looking at it going, ah, so it did. Cool, right, okay, right. Thing. It's just, yeah, I love that kind of thing, and that's why I'm so invested in just like putting the name out there, because I'm like, this shit's really good. I can come up to Aberdeen and see it.
Yeah.
It's ace. So I think that's is that enough of us just having a little bit of a love for WrestleZone and that we could move on to maybe other bits. No, no, we'll probably still go back into it.
So you're right about it. I think, you said about Anarchy having 10 matches, and that is a concern because it's a lot, but I think there is also the recognition of, in the past, the Beach Ballroom and even the Ledger Center with bigger shows, like, it's the whole perception of, still making this feel special without having to fill a big venue or not wanting to have to fill a big venue because of reasons just now. So I think that's the mindset there. It's like, I mean, it's one, and it is all semantics. If you could say it's the biggest Anarchy of all time, well, it is, but it isn't. It is and it isn't. But it's not the Beach Volume. Yeah, but 10 matches, though. So it is the biggest. And then we say that main event's the biggest match in wrestling history. And by the time we got to it, people fucking believed it.
Mm-hmm.
Because we knew those three guys would fucking pull it off. And they did. And that goes to everyone played their part in it, right down to the guys opening, the guys in the main event. Every single person on that show had a part to play to make that show feel that people had gotten what they wanted, but not so much that they didn't want to come back again. Mm-hmm. And that's a fine line with 10 matches. That's a very fine line. So some of the matches, and I know because I've heard you talk about it, there's so many matches like, well, this feels very, very odd and random. And it's too inside baseball, so I'm not going to get too into it. But there was a reason for everything. And it's bigger than, oh, this will be a good match.
Mm-hmm.
There's definitely a logic behind some of the matches that seemed odd. There was definitely a reason behind it. There's definitely a reason. And it worked. So, that's good. Yeah.
We didn't even kind of touch on, but I said the end of Summer Hill and everyone was going crazy, and we were floating and all that kind of stuff. Well, except me, I looked like I think I looked stunned. We'll go with stunned because my face doesn't really do emotion. Yeah, I know. No. I was like, oh, I don't want to block the people behind me. But no, I think the MVP of that particular video is Kelly. Is Kelly? You can hear her voice from the other side of the hall. The other side of the room, absolutely going batshit, and you would think if you watched that she was the mega fan, and I wasn't. When I look it back, that's why I thought, right, fuck it, for the Rumble, I'm gonna shout at you bastards the whole night. I'm gonna shout at you all. I'm gonna do all the things, and then by the time I got to the end of it, I'd called Dennis so many names under the sun, and I'd had my head in my hands, and oh God, I was a wreck that night. It was just wild, and I wasn't ready. I just wasn't ready. And I don't, if it, when it comes out, it is out on DVD now, the Rumble. I think if I ever watch it back, I'll probably end up watching myself more, going, at least look like you enjoyed yourself. Just look like you enjoyed yourself, because you did. Because you did enjoy it.
Raptors.
I know. It's so irritating because my face just does not do emotion, and I really want to, but no, I got to curse Dennis quite rightly for his shenanigans. Although to be fair, he should have thrown Kyle out. I will say that. So I think I would actually find that hilarious if he did. he threw Kyle out mid match.
We can't have fans putting hands on the wrestlers, Billy. That's wrong. I mean, that's a lifetime ban there. I'll leave it to management. I will bring it up to management. But I like Kyle's bad news. He's bad news.
Kyle can come up, but Kyle can't. He'll sit outside.
No, he can wait in the car.
Although, it seems you're scary, isn't he, great at banning folk? Because I shouldn't be at Summerhill. There was a picture and everything.
Yes, there was. I popped for that. Big pop. Big pop.
Yeah. But slipped past everyone. You know, face masks. Thank God the rules were still back in effect at that point. Right. Let's try to do some questions, I suppose. Why not at this stage? We've got so many. Most of them are the same kind of question. You may have noticed when we were going through them. So we'll leave all the favorite moments a little bit later on. We'll start with Mickey Vagos.
Okay.
He just asked quite simply, "Can I have an import?"
He hasn't had an import in quite a long time. Really, I mean, he worked with Devon, then he worked with Hurricane, he worked with Kalito, and he worked with Bull. So we don't talk about Bull. It's called Bull. If he's a good boy, I'll see what I can do. If he can put this whole thing with Ronan King to bed and focus on an import, then yeah. But right now he's got too much in his mind just now with Ronan King.
So I mean, who do you think would it be? Good Brothers versus the Ejected? I think that's probably, that could be quite high in the list of probably really? Wants.
Unfortunately, the most natural match for the Good Brothers is Vago and Brad Evans, but Brad Evans is one of the foundations. So I don't think that's going to work. Because Vago and Brad Evans are the massive marks for Gallows and Anderson. So we need to speak to Dynamite if we can have Vago have Evans on loan for one evening and they can take on the Good Brothers. Otherwise, I don't know.
I do know the easiest way to solve this is clearly a battle bowl.
Me and Mr. P have spoken about, like, because he occasionally bring up battle bowl. It's like, let's just do a battle bowl for real on a show. It's like, for fuck's sake, Dave. Like, just completely, legitimately at random teams drawn and just see what happens and just go out and do it. It's like, So now that you've mentioned it, I'll know if Mr. P watches this because he'll bring it up again. Because you're reminding him about Battle Bowl.
I mean, obviously some of the matches are already set for Battle of the Nations, but Battle Bowl of the Nations, you know, it's very easy pivot there. You don't need to do anything particularly. We just post it on the ring apron, just put bowl on it. Done.
I'm going to make a note of that just now, Billy. I'm writing it down. Look, it's there. No, Battle Bowl of the Nations is not the worst idea you've had. Not bad. It's not bad.
I mean, I don't think I have any bad ideas.
No, of course you don't think that, but...
Except going to Elgin, I suppose, when there was a show in Aberdeen, Christmas Chaos. That was a bad idea on my side of things.
To travel at the Perth instead of go to Lossiemouth, that was a bad one too, but we don't talk about that.
Yeah, you definitely have listened to the K&K pod. Great, fantastic. But fun fact, I found the name of the one of the DVDs that I bought that I wasn't aware that it was, you know, something else. And I don't know how, I was very naive, clearly, when I was younger, because I looked at the DVD cover and I was like, how did I not know what this was?
Is that the Wrestlelicious DVD?
It's even worse. It's called Women's Extreme Wrestling.
I know what you're talking about.
Ah, okay. Yeah, fine.
Fine. Don't worry.
Yeah. So
I am aware. But I don't own them. Unlike.
I know. I'm just very worried that they are in my loft and in my parents' loft. And my little cousins really like the wrestling. I'm very afraid they're going to watch them.
Uncle Billy is the coolest uncle ever. Oh, what's this?
It's Hot Booties Getting Kicked. It's extreme.
Uncle Billy really is the coolest uncle ever. Turn that off! Turn that off! How dare you?
That's fine. She was in TNA. Fucking right she is. No, get that off. There's I don't have any regrets about doing that podcast, but there's some, like, I wake up occasionally going, did I actually say that I bought porn on a podcast for people to listen to? Yes, I did. Great, that's fine. But, you know, it is what it is.
In your defense, you did not know what you were buying.
Exactly.
Although you should have looked at it a bit closely, but you didn't. But you didn't really know.
I was young. I was just naive and young. I did a lot of stupid things around about that time. I went to Perth, for fuck's sake. Right, so...
the SWGM? Right here? What?
Again? Yeah. Finalist? I was one of the top five.
His tie came off and everything.
Like I said, off the record, I'm a man of many talents. Not good at any of them, but I've done a lot of things in wrestling that's a bit weird, and that's one of them. I didn't even go tell them that I did posters. I did the Rock and Wrestle posters for ages as well. I made them.
Okay. All right.
Including the Ryback one. So that was one I did. So there's a fun fact for people.
Ryback.
Yeah.
No
chance he's coming to Aberdeen anytime soon now.
Fuck that. I want an easy life. Maybe when I was 20, I'd have put up with that shit. I'm waiting to be 42 this year. I don't care. Fuck. I don't care.
Speaking of that, of course, after your many appearances on my podcast and the like, you then appeared on the Mosh Pit. I think you were the first guest on the Mosh Pit as well, weren't you, for Vago? How do you, I mean, of course, when this one, even though I try to be as relaxed and cool and hip and happening, people do kind of maintain a semi sort of professionalism when they speak to me. I think it's just cause. But with Vago, that didn't happen. Of course you have no regrets, I suppose, but was there anything you did during those Vago sessions that you were like, maybe that could be cut out? Possibly.
No. Fuck that. No fucking way. Like, it's like, and even if that was the case, and there was something, I've said it, I can't take it back now.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, honestly, most of the people that listen to are maybe, you know, there's like some hardcore fans. A lot of the boys got a kick out of listening to them. A good 80% of the people who listen to that podcast have heard me say that to them in person. So what fucking difference does it make? It's like, oh, because everyone knew what the fuck I was going to say in it. It's like, oh, here he goes. He's off again. That's fine. Because the guys have heard it a million times. And they do what you do. They say something and prod me. And then I just fucking go. Showing me bad wrestling on purpose, you know. Like Aspen was showing me bad wrestling. Hey Scott, have you seen this? Didn't I fucking start with your shit? But just watch this bit. For fuck's sake. And that's the fucking annoyed. I'm moaning about it. And it's like, why do you do it? Because it's funny. People enjoy getting me riled up because I'm easily riled up. I mean, that chat was about 2 years ago now. There's nothing on that I said that I didn't believe or didn't feel I was justified in saying.
Mm-hmm.
And no one's called me up on it. And if people would have called me up on it, then they're more than fucking welcome to, because I'm not hard to find. I don't care. I genuinely don't care. But no one has. I mean, I'm sure there's some person's moaned a bit, but they won't say anything. But fuck it.
Mm-hmm. But I think it was Zach. I spoke to Zach recently. I got through it without saying.
Okay.
I got I only called him a bastard a couple times. You know, it was fine. I got through it. No bother. But yeah, it was pretty much like I find Vago's podcast is like your older brother, like you're not your older brother is how I coined it. But it's like he's the guy that brings you cigarettes and gives you maybe a beer when you're 14 going, go on,
yeah,
have a sip, you like it, kind of thing. Because they'll come onto mine and be like, well, I really enjoyed that match. I think it was I really enjoyed the story. I liked it. And then they'll go into Vegas and go, I liked the match, but the guy who was wrestling was a dick. So, so it's like you get the rest of the story with Vago, especially like Marty Jones. I got the most PG version I could get, and then Aspen told the rest of it on Vago's podcast with everything else, like the knife and all that kind of stuff that came with it. So,
one bit I didn't mention to you, because I wasn't sure if the people involved would want me to mention that part. Mm-hmm. And then I found out after the fact that you told me that you were talking about that. I was like, okay, so you do know. Because that's the one bit of the story that I tend to omit, depending on who I'm talking to. Because it's pretty bad, but it was also out of self-defense. And I did not know that he did that until maybe the Tuesday after the show, and someone has said that. And you know when someone says something in passing, like they assume that everyone knows, and they mention, "Oh, you know, what happened? He did what? No, like yeah, but fuck." I didn't know that until afterwards, because that's what happens on especially a show that's busy. You tend to the week after a show is when you get all the little bits that you missed. So-and-so said that happened there. So-and-so did that. And obviously you can't be everywhere at the same time. So like there'll be a week after a big show and I'll get like drip fed little bits of information. Like I'll get a message from someone on the Monday and they'll mention that, whoa, what happened? Obviously, and it's not all bad stuff, like just funny stuff or whatever. So that's what happened. So that means when you get a group of like 20 to 30 guys all doing the same thing, there's going to be lots of different combinations, and you get. See, that for me, that's more fun or as fun as doing the show. It's all the shit afterwards that you hear. Yeah, especially with some of the guys that we've got. It's a good bunch of cunts. Is what we've got. But obviously Marty Jones is, Marty Jones was not a good cut, he was just a cunt.
That's it. I watched back that match after I got the rest of the story after recording, and so I went back and watched it because I own it on DVD, one of the DVDs I own, and then I watched it back. I was like, I didn't know at the time, but when you watch it back with that information, it's like, yeah, it's very clear what's happening. But again, people that are paying for the ticket, they don't know all this shenanigans. They won't notice it. But then, like I said, I had that info to go into watching it with. I was like, oh my god, this is so fucking awkward to watch now, because I know that Marty's there, trying to direct traffic when he's not wearing a high-vis vest. Or there was an early way I was going to go down with that, but I don't think I can actually put that onto a podcast. But he was very interesting. And that's about as much as we could probably say about Marty that's not even positive. Not slanderous, I suppose. Maybe. Fuck, he won't know how to watch this anyway. It's on YouTube.
Say about someone being slanderous. There's an easy way to avoid people saying these things about you. Don't fucking do them in the first place. It's not fucking hard. Seriously, I've got no sympathy for someone. Like, just fucking behave. Just fucking behave then. It's like, I'm sorry. That's why I just don't regret anything I fucking say now. I really don't.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't want people saying bad shit about you, don't do the bad shit. Not fucking hard.
Mm-hmm.
That's my annoyed now, Billy. I'm fucking annoyed now.
Yes, it only took, not even 45 minutes. Excellent. No,
I wasn't even involved in the match, and I'm pissed off on everyone's behalf.
That's the speaking of, if don't be a cunt, pretty much, is the kind of general. But that kind of summed up 2020 quite well as well. When you see all the notes off apologies, and you're like, I'll just don't fucking do it in the first place, idiot. That would be good. Don't touch them. There we go. Problem solved. Anywho, let's not get back to that. We probably already went into that previous episode. I think we did. And I've already mentioned a one-legged pedo once this month. I think once in the last couple of weeks. I think I'm okay with not mentioning any more nonsense if I can totally avoid it. We'll move on to another question. I'm not my notes are away now. I'm not bothered. We'll cover them when we get there, I'm sure, between
here's why people come on to your podcast and they act professional, because they think you're actually a journalist when you're fucking not.
No, I'm not.
All these fucking noise. Oh no, I know you're not a journalist, but people think you are. And you've got all these notes that, nah, just leave it. It's like you're bad as fucking Vago. And now you're drinking as well. You're just Vago. You're just Vago.
Ah, but I haven't passed out on an episode yet. That's still...
just slowly starts going.
I've got the quiz episode at the end of the month, so that could be my final hurrah, and I'll just get to question whatever and just be going...
Slowly fade.
That was special. I loved watching that. I listen to it usually. I listen to the episode first, and then because I can just do it at my desk when I'm working, and then I'll go watch it later on. And I thought, as soon as I heard Vago disappear from the chat, I was like, I need to go watch this now. I need to go watch it as soon as possible because he has disappeared. I heard him mumble, and then that was him gone from the rest of the episode. And I was like, fuck, I need to get the YouTube up and the YouTube. I need to get the YouTube up and watch it as soon as possible, just to see what happened. And it's beautiful. It was incredible.
It was
a beautiful disaster. Everyone should go watch. That spun from his question, kind of have an import. That is how we've got to, we went from speaking about wrestlers to nonsense to Marty Jones to Vago passing out in his own podcast. This is why people listen to Scotty Swift questions. This is why people listen to the Scotty Swift ones, because we ask a question and the answer gets there eventually. And sometimes you don't get the answer you expect or either want. right, what else have we got there? Oh, speaking of things that I drip fed, did you hear Ronan swear at the Summerhill show?
Oh, Ronan King swearing at the Summer Hill show.
Yeah.
I didn't know it happened. Because of restrictions, we were trying to keep people separated, which is fucking hard, really.
Mm-hmm.
Because, trying to get people changing in different parts of the building. And we made it work. I mean, it was a whole big to-do, but we did it because we know what it'd be once you're taking a piss. So we didn't take the piss and we did it. So they didn't know I said there about how people talk about something and you're there, but you don't know what they're talking about, but they're being very nonchalant about it. So obviously the VIP match was Vago and Ronan. It was quite cool to see how their deal has developed. They had a match in Summerhill, and now it became like a real highlight of the shows is those two. Slight tangent, low key, my favorite thing in wrestling this year is those two together.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't mean in WrestleZone, I mean just in wrestling. I just love the metalhead against the pretty arrogant young guy. It's those two, you couldn't get two more different people, and it's just fucking gold. And it's sometimes it isn't the prettiest and it isn't the cleanest of what they're doing, but it looks legitimate and it's like just the contrast with those two is another example of why I fucking love WrestleZone. And it's when those two is that's one of my favorite things in wrestling this year is those two, because it just became something real for me. I think it's really special. So I didn't know that he swore, and now Nova's jumped in the bed. Yeah, you come down. Hello, Nova. I see you. So none of them. I'm assuming it went fine. First time they've had a match together, so first time pairing can go either way. But I heard it went well. People enjoyed it. It was cool. And then someone mentioned about Ronan dropping F bomb. I think I don't know who I was talking to. I think I might be talking to Caleb. Hey Caleb, maybe Evan. I can't remember. There's a couple of guys I see. No, I know Archer was there as well. I was seeing the guys, and someone mentioned, Ronan dropped the F bomb, and they went, he did what? It's like, oh no, do you not know? It's like, not know what? So, Ronan just lost himself and just said, I'm fucking amazing. And I went, and I said, how did people take it? Is it? It was fine, don't worry about it. But it's like watching it back, and it's that beautiful moment where you think, if I quickly say something immediately afterwards, I'll somehow be able to take it back. It doesn't work that way, because once it's there, it's fucking gone. You sitting there, you didn't even fucking hear them.
But I know. Kelly did. That was the fucking weirdest thing. I'm like deaf on one side. I'm like this side I can't hear much. So I must have been turned at the time. I can't explain it. I didn't fucking hear it.
Yeah.
It was gone. But no, Ronan is providing some amazing moments.
Yeah, like so I hear it. Oh God. So I hear about it after it's happened. And then eventually he bumbles up the stairs one time and I'm like, Hey! You know, they're trying to make it on like he's in trouble or something. And it's like, what happened? It's like, I don't know what happened. It's just, it's like, yeah. Because I mean, like Ronan King, bell to bell is a fucking twat. But out west, he's not an idiot and he wouldn't have done that on purpose.
Mm-hmm.
He's a pain in the arse. Once he gets his mum's jacket on, he's a pain in the arse, and it is his mum's jacket. I mean, I've heard him saying that at the Academy show. And his mum was at the Academy show, so I enjoyed that. I was, that game, that, you know, I spoke about the match with Super Executioner, and you know, like Brian McKenzie having the deodorant.
Mm-hmm.
And then I get 2 minutes worth of material. It's like Ronan King's mum sitting in the crowd, and he's wearing one of her jackets. That's me. I've got it. This is my 5 minutes here. Done. Brilliant. Easy. I don't need to lock up with him yet. I've actually got 5 minutes to play around and have fucking fun. So that was the story behind that. He just got caught up in it. He lost himself. And he won't do it again. He's learnt. He's like, oh my God. It's like, yeah. It's just a moment. Trying to take it back, but it's too late. It's all over now.
As long as he's kind of, I don't know if he spotted when Anarchy when he hit Vago with the guitar, and then threw it back and he hit someone with it. But I think I don't know. We won't speak about that as much as possible because you know, just in case that person's listening, they might still have.
We talk about that. No, we can't talk about the new Bragala that we did last week where Conor Malloy and Ronan King had a match and something happened with like one of the kids had like an inflatable football and Conor kicked it off of Ronan and it bounced off Ronan and it hit some kid in the face. It's like Ronan being involved with punters accidentally being in the line of fire. Like that was no one's fault. It was just, I mean, no one got hurt.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just here's another thing to feed to the narrative of Ronan King throwing F bombs, hitting people with guitars and football. So now the narrative is, and we can just constantly jab them with it. And it's like, come here, you. So,
the liability of Ronan King. Anyway, so he has asked a question.
Correct.
he asked, right, it's a bit of a long one. So. That's what she said. How amazing must it feel to have been the one to start a young Ronan on his wrestling journey? And how amazing did it later feel to experience his massive muscles when he was throwing you around said ring?
Well, I mean, the second part of that wasn't a lot of fun because getting thrown a bit hurts. The first part legitimately is one of the proudest things I've ever been a part of. Like I said, bell to belly, he's a pain in the arse. Out with, he's a good kid, and he is. It's funny, I was joking with him in the early days like the under 16 guy training and stuff. And that never really took off. Used to get a lot of interest of like, you know, it'd be moms or big sisters would get in contact and say, oh no, my son or my brother's mad in wrestling and really want to do it. But kids fall out of things quite quickly. You know, it could be 1 year they want to do this, and then next year they move on to the next thing, which is fine. So really only Evan and Ronan are the only two guys that stuck it out. They were the only two that showed the aptitude or had the, who were switched on enough to get it. Evan got it quicker than Ronan up here. It was funny, like every now and then on my phone and like in my gallery and videos, and I keep getting these memories. Like, remember the this day and this year, and a video popped up of Morgan, like really, really young Morgan in the ring doing like a little running spot, and it just wasn't good. He just was all over the shop and he was all gangly. And I made a point of saying to him, it's like something popped up on my phone and you wouldn't recognize it's him. You wouldn't recognize it. He came back after the lockdown and came back. Oh, nobody's leaving the phone. They came back after lockdown and I went in by, because I was in on a Monday, because we're in bubbles and stuff. So I had my guys. Guys have been a Tuesday and a Wednesday and a Thursday, Friday. But then things started to slacken off a wee bit and we can mix a little bit. So I just went in by one Tuesday to see the guys that I haven't seen in like a year, because Evan was in on a Tuesday and so was Morgan. And I hadn't seen either of them in like a year. So I just wanted to go in by and say hello. So I went in by and see Evan, speaking away to Evan. And then I see this guy, this like tall, well-built guy, walk in to my right side, and I'm thinking, oh, this must be a new guy, because I don't recognize this from side. I don't recognize this guy. Who's this guy? I don't remember there being a new guy in a Tuesday. And it was Morgan. Like, Morgan had left, like, lockdown, COVID, and then he came back after that, and he just became like a young man. I just looked at him and said, I didn't recognize you. He's like, hey, Morgan, how you doing? All right, Scott. And I was like, holy fuck, what the fuck happened? He just went woo, and that was it. The light bulb came on. So Evan had his light bulb moment before Morgan, but then Ronan came back after the lockdown and stuff. And it was just like something happened when he was away. He was watching a shit ton of wrestling, and he was saying like a lot of the stuff that I was saying to those guys when they first started, he started to apply it to what he was watching and things started to make sense in his head. And then he came back to training and everything just went boom. And then he got a character and it was like, holy fuck. It was just it's the biggest transformation I think I've seen in anyone that we've ever had. And it's amazing. It's like, it actually was fucking amazing. Thing is, like, he's not lying. He's right, but just don't say it in front of kids and stuff. But what he said was factual. Like, he is fucking amazing, because he was like a shy, awkward, gangly kid who wasn't quite getting it, but I knew had the potential physically to do it. And then he just became like a young man overnight, and he came back and it was like, that's it, boom, he's in. I was like, holy fuck. It's like, we all marvel, honestly, I do. That fucker's going to be everywhere. He's great. He's fuck. And the best part of it is he's sound as fuck. No, the Ronan King's a fucking pain in the arse. And on Twitter, he's a nightmare. But the guy behind it is such a good guy. So, to answer the first part of the question, it feels fucking amazing. I brought it back full circle.
There we go. The most impressive thing I found about Ronan, of course, you've got us nerds speaking about it on the old podcasts and what have you, and that's great, that's good. But nowadays it seems to be a lot of social media is where you find out about things. I was speaking to Ian Skinner yesterday, so that was the last episode I recorded. When my internet comes back on, you'll find out the rest of the story. He was saying that because of things like we did the tournaments, and he said because of that, he got picked up by Discovery, because he noticed his content and that's how he got, that's how he's picked up by Discovery. And we've got Ronan King on there, and he's fully committed. He's all over the place. If WrestleZone's mentioned, he is in the conversation somewhere. He pops up. We'll put a picture up. He'll say he's a terrible wrestler, and now that's unfortunately a screenshot that he will have to live with forever, saying that he can't wrestle. So he's tapped into the whole the new way of wrestling, the social side of it, which, you know, just means that everyone's going to go, oh, I went to go see WrestleZone for the first time. I saw the guy on Twitter, Ronan King. He was saying something. He was saying something, and I saw him get beaten up, and then he won, and I booed him. He's very intelligent for someone who's disgustingly young and just being so good at that age. It makes my knees creak just thinking about it.
It's disgusting. It's fucking disgusting. And I'm just very glad he started with us. I really am. Like I said, it's just the turnaround in him. I've never seen such a turnaround in someone like that. He's got all the time in the world. And he can go as far as he is. Like it's up to him how far he wants to take it at this point. He still needs to he needs to keep doing what he's doing now. And then when the time is right, he'll know. Because there's a couple of guys now who should be thinking about, if you want to do more, we're getting there now. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like Bradley's done it, and Evans has done it, and Ryan's done it, and Dynamite's done it. There's that next wave of guys. Well, obviously, Caleb's done it. There's a next wave, you know. Like Dino, I was speaking to people about, I think in time with a bit more with them as a team, I was like Dino and Murphy as a pair of big cunts as a team in Scotland is quite unique. It's unique. Like, there's not this overwhelming sea of big fucker tag teams in Scotland. That's something. That's something. I think Murphy needs to just keep doing what he's doing. Dino being with him helped. Connor Malloy can be everywhere. Ronan King in time will be everywhere. Evan Young needs to just keep building confidence, and eventually he can do more. Reese Dawkins is super new, but you know, I fucking like his gimmick. And I know, and again, I'm biased, and I know I'm biased, because Reece Dawkins is another one. He's a cunt when the bell rings, out with it, he's time to fuck. And I know I'm biased, but it's also, and like, I know I'm not bigging people up just because I like them. I'm bigging them up because they're really fucking good. And that's the beauty of it. It's like, not only that, it's like, but I know they're good for it. Some of them already are, some of them will be, some need a bit more time. Just getting more time, getting more comfortable, having the confidence. Because going to another company in a different locker room can be a big, scary, intimidating thing. Yeah? And you may have like these kind of perceptions of what it is. It may not be what you think it's going to be. It may be better, it may be worse. But when you've been around the same group of guys month in, month out, going somewhere else can be a scary big thing. And I think having the foundation boys traveling together helps. I think going to a different company but seeing Caleb there helps, because it's someone that you know. There's some things you don't always have that. You know, you'll go to a new company and it's people that you might know, but they're not necessarily your friends. So people you know only by name, or you've seen them on Twitter. And it can be big and scary. I think it's more so for the younger guys. It's a big scary thing. But I say to guys, like, what you're doing here isn't any different than what you'll do elsewhere. You know, I mean, there may be a change in some in the like in some of the crowd, but you're still in a ring taking bumps. You're still hitting the ropes. There's still people watching you in your pants. It's the same fucking thing, just a different place. And sometimes it's better, sometimes it's worse.
Mm-hmm.
As some of the guys are finding out, different experiences, and your perceptions might not be what you thought they were. And not every company is going to be, and I say it, not every company is going to be as organized as WrestleZone. There, I said it.
Yeah, and I mean, and not every company is going to have another company trying to sabotage shows. You know, it's different places for different situations and atmospheres as well. But no, the Foundation guys, the shows I'm seeing, of course, I watched the last couple of Fair City shows, and it's so great. It's weird because I've watched Wrestle for so long. I mean, coming up next year. June 1st next year will be 10 years since I got introduced to WrestleZone as a company. And now I'm seeing like the Foundation guys going about, and I'm almost like, in a weird way, like a proud, I won't say a proud dad, but I'm probably about the same age as some of them. But I'm like going, I watched you at the start, and now I'm seeing you wrestling all over the place and doing all these cool things and all that kind of stuff. It's just nice. It's nice to see. It's heartwarming, and when you go watch a show like I was like, oh, at least I know some of these names, I've seen them actually wrestle live, kind of thing. And it's same kind of thing with like seeing people grow. Omar being another example, I saw one of his first match at that Action Academy show for W3L, and I fucking tore him apart. In a review. And he's genuinely one of my favorite wrestlers going right now. It's amazing to see it. It's just amazing to see that kind of transformation happen, because he's sensational. I mean, that's the whole thing he's going for, but he really is. And of course, you got to team with him. I think once, because you're supposed to team with him at the Rumble. Twice, because Summerhill as well. What was it like getting the old Kamiz? Yeah. It was like the jacket for your entrance. You looked like you loved it.
Oh, I swear to God, when you like some guys, when they put their gear on, they change. Some guys inflate. I always remember like the story. You hear about stories about Scott Hall, like rest in peace. How he'd be in his street clothes and just kind of bumbling about. Then he would put on his gear and do like 10 push-ups, and he would just like just totally inflate and then become a different person. Some guys are like that when you put your gear on and it's like, hey, okay, it's just everything changes. I enjoy the process of putting my gear on. I don't enjoy putting my boots on because it takes so long, but the whole process of putting my gear on and doing my hair is like, okay, now everything changes. But I was saying to Omar, I don't know if it was my idea or Omar's idea. I think maybe he mentioned it kind of jokingly, and I said, "Oh no, I'm up for leaning into everything because he did the Proving Ground show in 2019 against Caleb, and people warmed him, and then." He was going to be in for the Rumble 2020, and then the world ended. And then when things opened up again, and then Dino couldn't make the first show back. So Omar had moved to Aberdeen for uni. So it's like, well, Omar's in Aberdeen now, and I like him. It's like, everyone likes him. So he's in Aberdeen. If he can help us out, you know. And it just kind of became... My story with the outfit became our story with the outfit, and it just organically became a thing, which is what I wanted. I wanted him to be a part of it, because people very quickly took to Omar, and I think he mentioned me wearing his. Oh yeah, I would definitely do that. So it was like, how that? So you want the glasses? Do you want the scarf? Give me everything. Because I actually bought one. because Omar had one he wanted to give to me, but I couldn't fit in it. Mm. So, either he found an auction on eBay or I did, he's messaged back and forth one night, and it's like, oh, I found a red one. Is it okay? So, we'll send me the link and I'll buy it. And then he was gonna buy it for me. It's like, no, you're not buying me. It's like, I'll be paying for it. So that became an argument, because this is how lovely Omar is. Like, he wanted to pay for it for me. He's like, no. Like, no, I'm paying for it. It's like, no, I'm paying for it. And then he came to training one night to give me money, and it's like, give me the money back. I'm not taking your fucking money. I'm paying for it. But like, he's tried to buy one at eBay, and it says, have you looked at the size of it? It's like, no, it's like, that's not going to fit me. Oh, I never thought about looking at the size. But it's like, that's not going to fit me. So I bought my own, and I'm looking at it right now. It's hanging up right now. And like, sure, mate, loves it. She thinks it really suits me. Like, oh, is that okay? That looks amazing. Is it looking good? So that, and the scarf and the glasses and everything. So when we did the whole thing, he comes out with it, I come out, he's annoyed at me, we go back, we do the change, and then I come out. I swear to God, I changed completely. I swear to God, I changed. I swear to God. And I was so looking forward to the Rumble, because it would have been myself, Omar, and Damien all wearing the gear.
Mm-hmm.
They would have been all come out dressed in it. And obviously, I wasn't there, so we were all speaking back and forth. And it's like, guys, we are going to get Turbo Team tonight. We're not going to have it. Like, I know. It's like, I'm fucking raging, because I was so looking forward to the three of us coming out and just fucking rocking it. So, I've been around for a long time, and everyone fucking knows who I am. Omar's kind of new. If I somewhat adopt his stick, if that in any way, if it helps in any way, if that kind of, if people see him and think, oh, Scotty's wearing his stuff, like, he must be cool.
Mm-hmm.
He summed this up, because if Scotty's, he summed this up. That's it. So just, let's just completely get people into the idea of this kind of new guy. Let's integrate you in with the regulars. And let's just get you established. And also, I just thought it'd be fun.
I mean, it works. I mean, my barometer of like if someone coming into a company is a bit different now, because I've watched it for so long, and I report on it. Because, like I say, I'm not a journalist. And I try to tell everyone before we do recordings that I am not a journalist. So if I ask you a question you don't want to answer, just fob me off. I will not ask anything further. I'll move on. But my barometer now is Kelly. That is my barometer for, does this work? Because when Omar came out for Hijinks, and she mean, like, I love the music, I love this guy, I love this dancing, I love everything. I'm like, that means Omar's done his job perfectly. Because if she's like going, I like this guy, like, I know that's right. Because I liked Omar before, so I knew he was going to be good. But I can't really judge a debut the same way, you know, because of that.
Yeah.
So if I know that it works, if she likes it, I'm like, yes, that's fine. Omar's done it. I know I'm right in that Omar's nailed this debut kind of thing, which is nice to have, I suppose. A little like I said, barometer of, is this good or not kind of thing.
Now, sometimes it's hard for you to be objective, but Kelly can be objective, because like, she's got no reason to lie. There's no reason to not be honest. So like, she's completely, you know, she can be objective and be honest. That's what it is. It's all about being honest, and sometimes it's difficult. Like, you had issues being honest in the past. If someone's shit, it's shit. If someone's good, it's good. If someone's then it's and that's fine. It doesn't always have to be everything's amazing. It's okay to not like something. Mm-hmm. And but Kelly's just like, no, that was shit, I don't like that. Like, she hated when we were fighting all over the building. Totally get that, because that's not for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
I just fucking love having a fight.
That's it.
And every guy in that match was just like, you just have a fucking fight. fucking good. Okay, cool.
That's because, the beauty of wrestling. See, because,
and the thing as well, I mean, if it, obviously you can't do that if there's not a reason to do it. I don't do it for the sake of it. It's a reason for, you know, it's like, you cursed and knocked us out twice, we're going to fight you now. Okay, I get behind that. But, like, I mean, and also just doing, like, trying to have, like, a really, really good wrestling match. It's like, I'm not going to be able to give you that really, really good wrestling match anymore, but there's guys in the show that will give you that really, really good wrestling match. Like, it's like, you know, I can rattle off 15 names of guys that will give you a better match than I'll give you now. So what can I do tonight? So what can I do tonight that's going to be like all these guys have got the fucking wrestling covered.
Mm-hmm.
If the main event's Damien against Zach, well, it's fucking sorted. That'll be fucking amazing. Right. And then Austin comes back. Well, that's babies in the air. Well, what the fuck can I do? Okay. Let's have a fucking fight. And that's the way I'm looking at shit now, because, I mean, I can't compete with those guys in the pure wrestling state. I can't. There's no fucking point in, there's no point in trying. There's no point. Everyone needs to find, find their thing, but find their thing on any given show. You know, like, there's zero point in me trying to flip about like Conor Malone. There's zero point in me trying to move around like Zack Dynamite. There's zero point in me trying to throw people about like Killer Bahala. I need to find some middle ground. I need to find the in-between stuff. You know, or I just need to be the boy with the red fucking hair tonight. Okay.
You know? That's it. I mean, we were saying like, Arne Anarchy was amazing. It was probably the best show I've ever been to. But I think really underrated one that on the wrestling character has happened, on calendar that's happened, is the Ellen show. Because I went to it, and it's exactly that. There was the big hoss match. You had a wrestling match. You had a comedy match. You had something that was a little bit of a hybrid of both, a little bit high flying, a little bit of comedy with Brian Tucker and Connor. And you just had everything on that show. And it was just, I was watching it going, I'm so glad that I came to Ellen and watched this, because this, if anyone, this was one of the smaller shows, we'll say, because it's not like you're, it's not got a name. It's not Summer Hill Showdown. Yeah. It's not Hijinks or anything. But I came away going that, going, that would be a show that people will watch and go, oh, they've got an air show coming up. That's in Aberdeen. Oh, we'll go to that one, because I liked what I saw here tonight. And it's just, I think that's going to be it's one of those underrated shows I've seen, because it is a perfect snapshot of everything you're going to see at a future show. And it also had a little bit of story stuff for us nerds that have traveled all the way here that go to most shows or just about every show, because it just did the job it needed to do. But yeah, that was less of a question, more just a statement when it came to that kind of thing. But yeah, we have discussed in previous episodes that, yeah, wrestling's a variety show. I'm more of a story guy, I'm finding in my elder years. I'm finding, because there was like, I was watching Discovery, really enjoyed the show.
I'm the same as you.
Yeah, I really enjoyed the show. And the main event was Andy Wilde, Eric Young. It's going to be a fantastic wrestling match. No doubt about that. It was a really good wrestling match. And then, like yourself, you judge by your eyes and ears. Crowd loved it. Excellent. I didn't get gripped by it because there was no story. There was a little bit of a story, but not enough for me to go, oh, that was the total package of a show. But the crowd loved it. So I couldn't say it was a shit match, because it wasn't. It was just like, I liked it, but it just wasn't for me,
of course,
kind of thing. Yeah, so I'm getting better. I'm getting better at being critical at shows. But yeah, I did have a very long streak of going, I'll just mention the things I like and don't want to rock the boat. And now I'm like, this was good, but it could have been better. Or this could have happened, or could have missed this out. It probably would have been nicer. It would have been a better moment. But again, I'm doing the same now as eyes and ears. If the crowd love it, then I can't really go, I'm not shitting the whole match. The crowd loved it. Clearly they enjoyed it. Just wasn't for me. Next match, kind of thing. So I'm getting there. I'm getting there a bit more critical. But like I said, I'm not going to be hitting hot takes on Twitter anytime soon. Like I said, I'm kidding. Okay, just, that's just not me. I'm just not that kind of person.
It's not worth it. Really. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. It's not worth it.
Exactly. I've done my time doing hot takes, and I got hassled about for it. So fuck it. I'm the arsed. Like what you like.
Yeah. the thing, and also as you get older, your taste, like, you know, my taste have changed, or my taste has changed, or I've got a more of an appreciation for different things. And like, I love old shit, but I can say that for a lot of things. Like, I mean, like, I like old horror movies. I love the 80s. It's just a part of getting older, and sometimes a lot of it is that kind of it's the rose tinted glasses of looking back, but a lot of it, you know, it is fucking better. A lot of it, not all of it, but some of it has aged very well. But you saying there, oh, this match isn't for me. It's like, I mean, there's guys, there's matches that aren't for me, there's guys that aren't for me, but for me to say that those matches are bad or those guys are bad, it's fucking music, because that's ignorant. That's fucking ignorant. You know? And I fall out with people at training for people having stupid things like that. No, you need to think about it differently now, because you're wanting to do this now. You need to have a better appreciation for, and I'm like, and I'm not saying have new favorites or start liking things, because I told it to you. No, just have an appreciation for the things that your first instinct is to just dismiss, because those people should be a catalyst for you doing better at wanting to do the first thing in the first place. I still joke with Lewis Turner, and helped us with beauty, you know, he trained for a little bit back in the day, and just he made a passive comment, oh, just seen this shit. So I just fucking went off. And like 10 years later, we still bring it up. It's like, hi, Lewis, remember when? I said, yeah, I'm sorry about that. And it's like, don't be sorry. It's just like, I'm not saying to people, change your opinions. I'm saying, just have an appreciation for guys who have done really well in the thing that you're trying to learn to do.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's asking for a lot. You know, all these guys who have done really, really well at it should probably be somewhat of a, like, maybe look to them and see what they fucking did and why that fucking worked. Is that not like me? Is that look at the guys, like I'll help you and we'll help you, but look at the guys who are fucking really fucking good at this. Look at the guys who fucking did it for a living. And if you can't take a little bit from them, or at least appreciate why they were good at it, then come on to fuck. You know, and that's a Cena, and that's a Hogan, and that's an Austin. Yeah, you know, and Cena had 5 moves. He did well with him. What's your fucking point? What's your fucking point? That makes him a fucking phenomenal worker. Then the guy who got a lot out of a little is a phenomenal worker. What's your fucking point?
Especially think of that. He's had maybe a handful of injuries during that time, during his whole career. He had the he busted his arm doing that hip toss. He injured his ankle around Rumble. That's probably about it.
Well, injuries have stopped him, because he's the kind of guy who fucking works through it, because the guy's a machine. There's lots of injuries. No, there's lots of injuries that the guys have that we never hear about, because it just works through them. Unless it's a break or a tear or a rupture, guys will just work through it. Those are the injuries that we knew about. But I'm sure he's had hundreds of little things that would be like me and you offer work for a week for him, is it? Well, I'm fine. Because the guy's just a fucking machine, you know? It was when he tore his tricep and came back 3 months early. But what the fuck are you doing? You know, you came back at the Rumble.
Yes, 2008.
I think it was.
It was. Madison Square Garden. Oh, amazing.
And then he came. I just be back in time for maybe for Mania. And I love that return, because everyone at MSG, I think it was MSG. Everyone at MSG for a second forgot that they hated him, because they all fucking popped. And it's like, you fuck. But then it all went boo. I was like sitting there, I was like, oh, fuck you. Fuck off. You all fucking love the fact he came back. The whole place fucking erupted. And then it was, oh, no, we don't like him. And then you started booing him. It's like, get fucked, MSG. You fucking love them, Cena.
That's also, it. I mean, oh, yeah, go on.
Also, I just watched Peacemaker, and he's fucking amazing in it.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I loved it, Anarchy, that Mr. P and Sean Johnson started the dance, and I thought that is probably funny for about maybe half of the audience because the other half shouldn't be watching it. And I'm like, I love this.
During the day, Mr. P, because Mr. P said to me weeks ago, have you seen Peacemaker yet? I said, no. And it's like, but you need to. I will. And then I finally got around to watching it, and we watched it all like in one night. It was fucking so good. Then I saw Dave Anarchy, and I said, oh, I finished Peacemaker. And I said, what'd you think of it? Good as it is. Yeah, it's amazing. And I said, oh, you'll enjoy our music tonight. We're going to come out to the theme to Peacemaker. And it's like, that's amazing. So they came out, and I'm in the back fucking popping hard. But no one else is really picking up on it, but I'm popping fucking hard. It's like, and they've got a fucking choreographed dance going on. Yeah, it was great. Sean Johnson fully embracing the the sports entertainment is what I'm here for. I am here for sports entertainment, Sean Johnson. Absolutely. Great shit.
And it's on TikTok as well. It's got 1,000 views, over 1,000 views so far on TikTok. The old Peacemaker dance. It does, yeah, it is. That and I only put up two clips because the rest of them I didn't want to be a dick and just put up all the clips that I got because I was going to put them in the montage I did, out of context montage. So I put that one up and I put up Luke King Sharp's entrance. That was the only two bits I put up on TikTok and they both go over 1,000 views and all that kind of stuff. And it's like, that's pretty cool that people might watch this and go, oh, just hashtag WrestleZone. I'll go type that in. And oh, there's a show near me. And that's the point of my TikTok channel, other than me just watching the same fucking sounded videos every bastard day in my life. It's terrible.
I can't remember how we got onto Peacemaker, but we got there somehow.
That's God the thing. That's what we do.
I have no idea how we got there.
Oh, it was us moaning about big marks on the internet, right? So yeah, but pretty much I've lived my life. I don't worry on Twitter. Like I said, I don't do hot takes. I do the often mild one. But generally I will meet people that are negative because I don't need that shit in my life. And I'll basically, if there's a big whingy opinion going, oh, someone's shit, or we all us wrestling fans think they're shit, I just add mentally in my opinion at the end of it. And it just kind of, that cures the negativity for me because it just makes them wrong or just makes it their subjective opinion. And it doesn't, they're not burdening it on me going, oh, I'm a wrestling fan. Fucking lump me with you, you big sweaty dork. Leave me alone.
God
anyway.
Damn.
Anyway.
Dork. Wow.
Dork is a very underused, underappreciated word for people nowadays. I think it should be brought back. I'm now 1.5 beers because this is number 3. So, you know, things might get a bit spicy. As I am very, just, I don't drink a lot. I don't drink enough.
I can't give anyone a hard time about being a dork because all the shit behind me.
We're all dorks, it's fine, but don't be a big sweaty one.
Like, we're all fucking marks. Like, we're all marks. And it all comes down to having the awareness of the level of mark you are. Because being a mark, it doesn't necessarily have to be a bad thing unless you make it a bad thing. You know? And don't let it fucking define you as well. Again, and we've spoken before about the whole thing, and one thing just defines you, and that's all you have. That's not fucking healthy. Have other shit. You know, like I said, I think I said to Vago years ago, it was like, sometimes I need to not look at fucking wrestling. Because I watched WrestleMania, and that's the last thing I've watched.
Right. Fair enough.
I forgot Backlash was on. I remember the Tuesday. Oh, I'll get around to it. Never watched it. I'm sure that's fine.
I forgot NXT TakeOver was tonight as we're recording. And I was like, oh, fuck, I'll stay up and watch it. It's cool.
Did not know it was even on tonight in any way whatsoever. Mm-hmm. I have no idea what's happening with NXT. I don't know. I would pretend that I know. I don't know. I'm shit. I know I'm shit.
That's it. I mean, I'll watch pay-per-views. That's pretty much. I'll catch up with some bits and pieces when I'm when like have a morning dump. I'll go through YouTube I go, right, that's what happened on Raw last night. Creep, creep, right, done, cool. That's my day done. I don't have to think about it. I mean, the only thing that's really defined me is I spend an enormous amount of time doing this, the website and tweaking it and all that kind of stuff, which I know come August, fucking can't do that. So I'll cross that bridge when I come to it. The thing with the whole defining stuff, but
I think I get my rest. I know. I think it's that. I think just thinking about it just now is like, so I don't watch a lot of wrestling, like modern wrestling or current wrestling. I get my wrestling fix from WrestleZone because I'm in it.
Mm.
I'm not like passively watching it from my far. I mean, I've got my hand on a lot of aspects of it. I've got the academy that I'm helping with. I love WrestleZone. I know like Ronan's question was half nice and half and you know, half dickhead. But the first half was nice. Like that shit keeps me going. Like that keeps me happy with the wrestling fix that I need. I don't need to watch Raw this Monday because I'm looking forward to Caleb Valhalla finally getting a chance in Alan Sterling. That's my wrestling fix now. You know, I get fucking into the shit as well as it's happening. The main event at Anarchy, and I'm watching it on the monitor, and I'm like, well, that's over, and it wasn't over. Oh, they've got me. They fucking got me. That's me. I'm fucking selling it now. When what you're doing in the ring, and the boys are selling it, and the boys are in, and they say afterwards, I thought that was it there. Got them. Because if you got them, you've got the audience. You've totally got the audience now. Because the boys have seen everything, or they have awareness of everything, and for the guys who've been around for a long time, they kind of know. They know. They know. It's like you fuckers got me with that. I thought that was it. I thought you'd fucking fuck. I was so in, and that's a beautiful thing. And that's my wrestling fix now. So I don't need to have my wrestling fix associated by watching a product that I'm not too into just now. But all these people that, I mean, you think about all the guys who were on the Anarchy card, apart from Air Miles, Alistair Karen,
Omar,
Looking Sharp and Krieger. Everyone on that show which came through the academy. That's fucking incredible.
Mm-hmm.
That's incredible. And you know, and that's a big part of why what we're doing is working, is because we have a crew of guys that are homegrown. I know some guys disappeared and went away. Aston went away, then he came back. But the guys who are, whether they're working elsewhere or not, they are identified as being WrestleZone guys. And that's where the investment's coming from. And unfortunately, some companies don't have that because they're not set up in that way. We're just very fucking lucky, and I will exploit and take advantage of that, and we all will, because it's creating amazing things, like the atmosphere and the morale backstage. Without getting too inside baseball, I'm not going to, but backstage at Anarchy is the best atmosphere I've ever been a part of, ever. Every fucker wanted everyone to do well. It was fucking amazing.
We were talking about like getting your wrestling fixed. I genuinely had a thought when I was like, oh, what am I going to do? Because I won't be able to do the podcast. I can, but I can't do it as regularly as I could. So I'll just like stop it, because if I can't do it regularly, there's no point. I won't enjoy it. And I was thinking, right, what could I do? I genuinely had a thought in my mind going, right, what do I like watching? What do you think I've got passionate enough that I could write about quite regularly? And I genuinely thought, right, what I'm going to do is a wee side hustle. I'm going to do a WrestleZone site as well. I'll do a blog about that. I just have it as my wee side piece kind of thing. It's like, I could probably knock out maybe 3 articles a week, no bother, on something. And that was it. And I was like, no, don't, that's too far. Let's reel it back a little bit. Let's just kind of keep going. WWE pay-per-views, WrestleZone, and then if I can get to a show nearby, that's pretty much my fix now. And of course, I'll keep up to date with everything else because I've got the site to do it.
I mean, that's all you need. And also, obviously, what we've spoken about it, but it's obviously always going to be an atmosphere. Like, your life's going to change soon as well.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, like, you're going to have to prioritize, and you're going to have to, you know, some things are going to have to just be not just now, because having a kid is significantly more important than people running sure. about. You know, as I say, guys, when something comes up and your life comes up, whether it's good, bad, or indifferent, it's, oh no, I can't do this, I can't do that. And it's like, don't worry about wrestlers, fuck wrestlers, get your life, no, get your shit sorted. Fuck that. You know, I mean, I've had some shit happen in the past 2 years, and I, you know, it's fine. It's not fine. It's shit. But it's life. This part is like, me getting older means that, you know, we're gonna lose people and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I say to guys, like, it's like I was like, last September I lost my dad on a Sunday, and I was in for training the next day on a Monday, because I was thinking, I may as well just be in and be just productive, because not being productive won't bring him back.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's how I dealt with it. And the Mondays, there are lots of people, there are new people, like, no, the only person really who's still around, who was in that night that I'm close to, was Ryan Riley. And I told him what happened. He's like, no, it's like, I'm fine, Ryan. Just, if at any point I'm off tonight, that's why. Mm-hmm. And he's like, well, I'll help you out. And he's like, I know you will. And it's fine. And everything was fine because being around him was what I needed.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And, but when I say to guys, like, I use that as an example. Then I say to guys, don't do what I did. Because that's how I dealt with it. But I would never want you to feel that you have to come and train after losing your dad. I was like, no, you do whatever the fuck that you need to do to be okay with what you're doing. I just thought, because everyone was messaging me, people asking, no, do you need me to come in and take over for you tonight? I said, no, I'm fine. It's like, because, you know, it's done. It was coming. It wasn't a shock. It was fucking shit.
Mm-hmm.
But I may as well be productive, because I needed wrestling on Monday night. I needed to be with Ryan and helping you guys, because Ryan's amazing within fucking you guys. He's mm-hmm. fucking amazing with him. Again, but no, bell to bell. The inspirational Ryan Riley is a fucking arsehole, but Ryan Riley out with the ring is fucking incredible person.
I'm definitely not comparing it, but last year, I don't think I've ever said this in the podcast, I haven't really put out anywhere else, but my mum was diagnosed with cancer. So I'm a non-emotive person, as anyone who's watched me at a show can attest to. I have anxiety with speaking to people in real life, but that's another thing entirely. So my kind of thing was just, right, what is the use of me worrying at this moment? What's happening? It's been diagnosed. Shit. What's the next plan? On the next plan, we're going to do this. Cool. Right. I won't worry until that happens. Then it happens. Yeah. Right, done this. What's the next plan? As long as there's a plan, a logic plan with it, then I'm fine. If thankfully she's recovered, she's in remission, doesn't even need to go back. It's all gone. It's all good. But it's a case of, if there's no plan, I will panic. But as long as I can go, right, what's next? Oh, the doctor's going to do this test. Fine. I can move on, I can park it, then I'll worry at the next stage. Did the test, what's next? Okay, so I'm going to wait the results, so I'll take a week. Cool, right, park it there. I'll worry in a week. That's how I compartmentalize. I'm very logical based brain when it comes to that stuff.
So I make total sense, and also, but I also think that you need to be that person, because other people around you
mm-hmm.
may be upset or panicking. It's like, to use more wrestling terminology, I didn't sell it for my mom's benefit.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
And then you know, like a big part of not selling it was fucking going to training and just being productive. And also not taking it out on the guys and not letting it affect anything. And I don't think I did. And I've been assured that I didn't. But I agree with you there. Like, so like as long as there's a logical, so like what are we doing next?
Mm-hmm.
What's the next part of the plan? What can we do to deal with this? Because that was the same way. And then, because you know, my dad had cancer as well. Unfortunately, they had the treatment and then it came back, and then that was it. But I agree with you. It's like you need to have, because there'll need to be one person in the family who just holds it the fuck together.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's what you were, and that's what I tried to be.
Yeah.
I don't know if I did it well, but I fucking tried to.
Mm-hmm.
I had one day when I just completely shut down, completely.
Yeah.
And that was it. I just had one day at work, and I just completely, and he wasn't, and he was still with us, but I just, there's a year and a half of just stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I tried to get my parents moved out and moved them into a care home and stuff, and it was during COVID. It was just a whole thing and other stuff that it's just like everything happened at once, and I just had one day work and I just showed no, and I just fucking broke down. I completely mm-hmm. broke down. But apart from that, I think.
Yeah, it's such a weird thing because, yeah, I'm that person, but. It's a weird thing because we will get to the moments and the questions. We may have to rattle through some of the moments when we get to them. But yeah, for me, it's weird because, yeah, I'm that logical brain person. I'll compartmentalize. As long as there's a plan, I'll be fine. But I've got gout. Like, no, I'm not from the 1930s. I've got gout and it flares up two things, vinegar and stress is the second right. thing. So Kelly's again, she was great. She knew what my process is. As long as I've got a plan, I'm okay. But at the same time, I was struggling to walk because my gout flared up. And she was like, I can tell you're stressed. You can talk to me. And I'm like, I know. But I know what my process is, but my body's rejecting it, the process. At the same time, it's like going, no, you're stressed. You need to speak about it. It's like, I don't want to speak about it. Yo, no, I'll make sure you don't walk until you speak about this kind of thing. It's such a weird thing. But no, when the news came through that it was all gone, literally like 2 days later, my gout was cleared. I was like all relaxed again. It was so, the body is a fucking curious thing. it just tells you what you need to know
it's like an amazing thing, and it can also play tricks on you as well and make you think you're feeling something that you're actually not.
Mm-hmm.
And then like a good night's sleep, you can wake up the next day and you're fine again. You know, it's we're very resilient. Human beings are very, very resilient, thankfully.
I think we'd get into that kind of deep chat for a podcast. So we'll change that by just going through. We've got loads of questions, so we'll still try and get through them before 10 o'clock. So we'll go through the moment once.
And no, like you said, we wouldn't get to 2 hours.
I know. Fuck it. I was absolutely wrong. So moments. There's so many of them.
We're taking a bit more time now.
I know. This is taking a turn. Right. So Ask Me Faith kind of kicked off this thing by asking.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah. So I asked, favorite Ask Me Faith moment.
See, I can have. I can have a silly moment or a serious moment or like a silly, like a personal moment. Like, no, I hope you'd be okay with fucking sharing the personal moment. I think. A silly moment, is like where he recently made me laugh a fucking lot. He was laughing at his own fucking shit, which is really arrogant, but also makes me laugh. On the way to the Academy show this past April, he was on the bus and he had, you know, time to kill on the bus. So he started coming up with all these like names of wrestlers, but they were based on like towns, you know, like Huntley and Brecon and all that. And he had one in particular that was fucking hilarious, and we were in tears laughing at it. So he came in the door, said hello to him, and then straight away, right, I'll be thinking of all these names. Like, oh, okay, so what? And he's got, I've got him on the phone. And the one he said was Bounce, Bounce, Bigelow, and I was fucking done. And there was lots of them, but Bounce, Bounce, Bigelow was like, that's actually fucking hilarious. And I mean, this is like favorite Aston Faith moment. Is it fucking the main event of Anarchy. Really, as a whole thing, I mean, that's definitely the. I mean, I know I haven't seen everything done, but I've seen enough to have an educated opinion to be able to say that that's the best match he's ever had. And I think he'd agree with it. And no, like, and I told him after the match, and it was quite emotional for our standard, you know, because generally it's just wrestling chat and just laughing at stupid shit, you know. So I told him as much, and I hope it meant something. I think it did. So yeah, that's my answer for that. A chivalry one and a serious one, and a personal one.
That's fine, and like that you kept them brief as well, which is even better.
I'll really try.
That's all right. I know, because we've got loads of Ghostbuster stuff to go through as well. So we've got Ronan King also put favorite Ronan King moment. I think you kind of really discussed it, but
he's fucking amazing. God damn it! that end springboard moonsault with the cane.
Oh yeah.
The springboard moonsault has been his white whale for many months, and when the time was right, he fucking delivered. That's my answer. That's the two answers. The funny one and the serious one.
Fine, we're rolling. Connor Malloy, ask favorite Connor Malloy moment.
My favorite Connor Malloy moment was this one time he came into training and he was just fucking jacked. I said to him, like, you're fucking jacked, man. It's like, good for you. That 450, hitting it, the same thing, 450, the 450 with his albatross. And I said to him for weeks, it's like, he's saying to me, that I'm not going to get this 450 shot. And it's like, yeah, you fucking will, of course you will. You can do anything. Of course you will. Behave. And then Anarchy came and he hit Riley with the 450. And I was like, fucking, I was popping. And as a guy who's not a flips or a moves guy, but I knew how much that meant to him. And I was like, fucking told you. And he did it. And I was like, here we go. So fully hitting the 450 because I know it was a thing that sounds silly to someone who is in it, but it meant a lot to him to get that off his back. Kind of like a personal thing. Achievement unlocked, tick, done.
And in any moment where he's gotten drunk and ended up outside on his roof of his flat and getting that stories that have been told in previous episodes. Go check out the Connor Malloy episode for everyone, because that gets explained a bit further.
I do have a drunk Connor Malloy story after the Hollywood High Drink show. They were out for a few drinks. It was 2 o'clock because they were open till like stupid o'clock because the boxing was on. I think it was a Tyson Fury fight or whatever. So we're all out for ages. It's about 3 o'clock in the morning, and I'm up at the bar, and Connor's at the bar, and we're at that point of the night where Connor's so drunk that he's going, like, oh, Scotty, I love you, Scotty. And I was like, I know you do. He's like, no, you don't understand. I love you, I love all the guys, I love wrestling, I love everything. And he's like, massive hug, and it's like, it's really okay. No, honestly, I mean, it's like, I know you do. The next day, can't remember a fucking thing.
Oh,
I can't remember a fucking thing, but I know he meant all of it. I love Connor. He's great. He's great.
We've got two. Well, I'll ask the other one that Omar's asked in a bit. But favorite Omar Muhammad moment, eh?
Oh, I know, eh? Omar Muhammad, eh? It is a sensation, eh? Definitely, eh? Favorite. It's like, no, we talk every day now. So it's like a lot of my favorite moments with him is just sending each other fucking stupid shit that only we would laugh at. I mean, like, in terms of, like, wrestling and stuff, and it's like, I'm an Omar fan as well, so I think Omar's great. A lot of it is just, like, us talking to each other. Our gimmick just now is just, or has been for a wee bit, is just saying the names of venues in Scotland in a Fife accent. That's it. Hey, Bonner Hall, hey! Definitely, hey, I know, hey.
Fire alarm, eh? So we've got...
No, fire alarm, eh? I know. Hey, Dave, low, eh? SWE, eh? Fucking eh?
We got about 2 hours. We got 2 hours before we got mention of that, of Dave Lowe. Wonderful. I may as well just go for one that'll... Well, we're in that kind of zone of arsehole. Kyle Watt asked, favourite alpha male moment? Was it him leaving?
No, again, here's the thing I said before. It's like, and I think I said to you, briefly to recap, was that I actually got along with him, but then, you know someone long enough, I guess you figure out what they're actually like. My favourite moment was the only exchange that Alpha Mill had with Billy Gunn at the first volume show. So, Alpha Male had hurt his wrist or his hand, he's bandaged up or in a cast or whatever. And obviously, Alpha Male's got he's a good sized guy, you know. So he's wearing like a tank top, so he's got the guns out, everything. And Billy Gunn's speaking to Alpha Male, and I happen to be there at the same time. And Billy Gunn's saying to him, oh, so why aren't you in the show? He's saying he's got a decent building and he's, you know, obviously looks like a wrestler. And at that point, he hadn't done anything for us before. He was just kind of, we were thinking about doing something with him, and he said, oh, well, I'm not on the show because I haven't worked for you guys before, and also, I've hurt my wrist. And Billy Gunn goes, oh, I see, you've got sand in your vagina, and then he walked away from him. So, from that point forward, I went, sand in your vagina, I'm stealing that. So I learned quite a few things from Billy Gunn in terms of wrestling stuff, but I learned that put down as a mic drop and walk away. I enjoyed that.
Wonderful. Reece Dawkins. Favourite Reece Dawkins moment?
Fucking hell, Reece. My favourite Reece Dawkins moment is the Monday before the Rumble where we both said to each other at training how lucky we were to have not gotten COVID, and then we both got it the same day. On the day of the Rumble. And they were messaging each other back and forth on the Saturday saying, Reece, we fucking jinxed it. Like, I know, we fucking jinxed it. Because Martin couldn't make ring announcing for that show because he had a gig that had been rescheduled because, like, COVID four times or whatever.
Mm.
So Reece was going to be ring announcer. So he was really excited for it and he'd be really fucking good at it. And neither of us were there. Because of COVID, and we're fucked up. So that's my favourite Reece Dawkins moment. Because right now, we had the match with Thunder at Anarchy and had a few matches at New Brigala. But yeah, the favourite moment is us fucking it. Yeah.
Fair. It's fair. Fair weather fans, eh? And they come to all the shows, Martin. Jesus. Right.
Fucking eh, I know, way. I'll be Anarchy. And so that was over.
Ryan Riley asked, favourite Ryan Riley moment?
Honestly, there's too many. There's too many of stuff.
Did you enjoy his performance in the quiz? In the Christmas quiz we did?
He did better than I thought he would. I was actually quite impressed with him and Connor getting some stuff right there. You know, there was a couple of times that I was watching it and I was shouting the answer at my phone. I was shouting the answer. I can't remember which one it was. It might be something to do with E.T. or something. E.T. was... No. The E.T. was released in what year? 1982! Favourite Ryan Riley. I think from a personal point of view, Ryan Riley was a guy who was always going to get it, but it was a matter of when.
Mm-hmm.
He had... Because he used to be a big lad. He wanted to do wrestling. He went, no, I'm going to drop the weight first and then I'm going to get involved. He lost 7 stone and then he got involved to be in a position to be not chasing himself. He'd be ready for it. And he was right to do it. And most guys wouldn't be that fucking, that switched on, which is apparently why he's done so well. But he wasn't getting the whole concept or the thought process of what wrestling was. And then neither of us can remember what we said, but it was one night we were both in, and apparently I said something to him, and a light bulb went off, and from that point forward, everything started making sense for him, and neither of us can remember what I said, but I stand by whatever the fuck I said, because apparently it helped. So from a personal point of view, that stands out.
He's also
there's a
asked,
lot of stuff that me and him fucking laughed at that no one else laughed at.
He's also asked a second question, which is second favourite Ryan Riley moment.
What? That's what he said?
Yeah, he asked also second favourite Ryan Riley moment.
I don't fucking know what. It's like, oh my God. I think from a wrestling point of view, the first time he really killed it on his show was the opener of Anarchy 2019, the rejected against the outfit against the Foundation of the Future. Mm-hmm. And they opened it with a triple threat tag match. And it was like this fucking really balls to the wall sprint. And sometimes sprints can be too much for me to process because I like having chances to breathe and I don't always like bang, 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 but those fucking 6 guys made it work. And they were all buzzing afterwards. They all fucking knew they know had a good one. And Ryan's had matches since then that were better, but that was the first fucking ball to the wall. Really happy with what he did. And I knew he was happy with it. And if he's happy, I'm happy. So that stands out. Although I do think that the tag match at Anarchy, the Connor Crusher against Evans and Riley, is now my favourite opener in history.
A solid choice. So that's all the moments questions done.
Okay. Okay.
We've still got like 12 questions to go from there. So, right. So let's do this.
Hold on 1 second. What I'm going to do is I'm going to get another drink, and I may get Adam to take Nova in the garden because I think she might kick off when I stand up.
Cool. I need to go for a pee. So that's fine.
Okay. Cool.
Back in a second.
Cool.
So then, mono means one, and rail means rail.
Oh, hey, okay.
Okay. We're going to rattle this out 30 minutes. We're going to be done 30.
So number one, liar. Liar.
We could do our best to be done in 30.
Okay.
Right, so some quick fire ones. Colin Bruce, when Scotty and Billy tagging for a match? I can answer that one. Unless you want to do all the work, never.
I'll do all the work. That's okay. I don't mind.
Cool. It's fine. I'll stand there and look pretty. Fine. So I'll take that one out of the list. There we go. Right. Adam Morrison, is Felix Fortune more or less of a Hall of Famer than Hillbilly Jim?
Less, because Hillbilly Jim worked a mania with midgets.
Perfect. That's that. Clip that. Right. So this one might be
a mania. More than I'll ever fucking do.
Michael asked, if it's a podcast or triple threat match between Mickey Vago's Mosh Pit, brackets, they've all had a few drinks, Kyle Watt and Kaylee's Wrestle Factory, and myself, who can either have 2 sheep or a cow in their corner, I'll pick 2 sheep, who wins and how? You don't have to pick me because I'm here.
Yeah, no, I think Kane can win because I think Killy would be a dirty fucking fighter.
Yep, fair. I'm happy to concede on that. There's two of them.
There's two of them. I mean, I can see Kyle trying to have some kind of a gentlemanly contest, and she just be in just fucking clawing and fucking biting and scratching and pulling, and it's like fuck that. Yeah, they win. Vigo, they win.
They'll be furious. Okay, so nice simple one, hopefully. Caleb Valhalla asking, he was looking forward to the Caleb section. Unfortunately, due to time constraints, we're not going to get all of that. He said to ask you about Hoss and Toss, and once he's done putting him over, and also ridiculous music at training.
Yeah, so we'll start with the music. You know, the music at training is like me and Caleb, and actually Blue Thunder a little bit as well. I like to put on the kind of music. There's a kind of music that I would only listen to when I've got my headphones in, because I wouldn't subject other people to it. But Caleb's got an appreciation for the heavier shit as well. So, you know, we'll subject the guys on the Monday to some death metal. Yeah, we'll have some proper scary shit going on there. As for Hoss and Toss, Hoss and Toss is the greatest tag team that's never happened, but could potentially happen one day. All I need to do is I need to get on like a lot of fucking steroids to get really fucking big. And me and Caleb are going to recreate Steiner squash matches and just chuck people all over the fucking ring. And we're going to be Hoss and Toss. So maybe coming to a gala near you will be Scotty Swift and Caleb Valhalla just dropping guys left, right, and center. Just fucking two big guys. Again, if I get on the steroids, which I won't because I'm scared of them, if I was to get really fucking jacked and really fucking big, we can just run through people and basically it'd be Rick and Scott Steiner. And that's going to be Hoss and Toss. In some alternate dimension, that's happening right now. We're just chucking guys into orbit.
And to put him over, I suppose, I love Caleb. I think he's just the best. He's such a lovely human being and just a beast of a wrestler. Yeah.
Hey, Caleb Valhalla is like, for my own personal criteria of what a wrestler should or could be in the ring and out the ring, he ticks every fucking box. He should be everywhere because he's great.
Absolutely.
Is that good? I love you, Caleb. Is that good enough for you? I've taken to calling him the Big Hoss Man. That's my nickname for him.
Oh, nice. I like it. He is. I mean, he really is. He's called Big Sexy Caleb for a reason. He really is. Stupid Sexy Caleb. Yes, that is.
God damn it.
Right. Okay. So we've got a bunch of Ghostbusters ones to go through. So again, back to Caleb Valhalla. Assuming it's going to be Ghostbusters related. You can only watch one show for the rest of your life. What do you choose?
One show?
Yeah.
Is that just like in general? One
I would
show
say a TV just... show. Yeah, a TV show you can watch for forever.
Parks and Recreation. Easy. That's my favorite show of all time.
Excellent choice. Excellent. But there's not a day goes by where if we're having to say a full name in this house that we do the Chris Traeger. Clicking points. Or if we see
that is the best thing you've ever said.
every time, just point. There we go. Right, name.
Amazing.
Also got Caleb Valhalla with where does he rank Afterlife among the Ghostbuster movies?
It's number three. The first one's the greatest of all time. The second one is a fucking. See, some days the second one is my favorite movie of all time, but I've got a deep fucking connection with that second film in a big way. Afterlife is number three.
So the natural order of things.
Yeah. Right now, my three favorite movies of all time are 1, 2, and Afterlife. I'm a big fucking mark. I know I am, but a few weeks ago, I watched all three of them back to back, and the fact that I live in a world where I can now have a trilogy makes me so fucking happy. You have no idea. No idea.
I love it. I love a trilogy. That's why. Well, we had to get you for a fourth episode, but I like getting a trilogy episodes as well. Like, so that's why I got Ian on yesterday. I just like it.
It's me, of course.
I mean, thankfully, this isn't going to be like a Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. This is going to be a decent fourth. This is going to be an excellent fourth episode.
Oh, I went to the cinema to see that, and it was not great.
Who are you? I would see Terminator Salvation. That was my fourth film. Woes.
I haven't seen Salvation.
Fuck me,
I
don't.
That's the only Terminator film I haven't seen. And I'll put my hand up and say, I thought Dark Fate was really good. Sorry, not sorry. I really enjoyed Dark Fate. I did.
Salvation killed it for me. That was it. Salvation killed it. Killed the franchise for me. So
I was going to watch it. I know, we'll watch it just to have seen all of them. But Genesis was also hard for me.
Mm-hmm.
Genesis. But I honestly thought Dark Fate kind of brought it back a little bit. I did enjoy it. It's big, dumb fun, but I did enjoy it. I did enjoy it.
Mm-hmm. We've also got, oh no, sorry, this is from Mrs. Valhalla. Not because I forgot her name. Mrs. Valhalla, house is on fire. You can only save one thing from your Ghostbusters collection. What do you save?
See, that on paper sounds like a hard one, but I would probably, what you have to do there, you need to think about something that is like irreplaceable. My one and only proper live auction, not eBay, like an actual proper auction open to everyone. This is what happens when you're during the first lockdown and you're not working and you're at home and you have spare time. So there was like a movie memorabilia and like poster auction. So I put in a pre-bid for a poster, like you pre-bid like before it goes live. And my limit was 100 times. And I put a bid in for 50 and I was winning it because it didn't mean anything because it's not live yet. But it was an original production used poster from the first Ghostbusters movie, but it came from the personal collection of Richard Edlund, who was the head of Boss Studios, who did a special effect on the movie. So to me, that's like, Richard Edlund worked on Indiana Jones, Star Wars, he is the fucking man. So it's his collection, I want that. That'd be a cool thing to have. But his personal collection, yeah, okay, that gets me itchy, really itchy. So my limit was 100 pounds. The auction goes live, and I'm winning for 2 seconds, as you can imagine. Straight away, I'm out of bed. So I'm like, okay, walk away from it, Scott. But I didn't, and I got fucking annoyed. So I bid a few times, and I was winning for a little bit, and then seconds later, I would get out of bed. Like, fucker. So my limit was 100 pounds, and already I'm over it now. So now I'm getting annoyed, and I've never done it before. No, like a live auction's a rush. It's like cocaine. It's a fucking rush. I haven't done cocaine, but I'm assuming it's like cocaine. Honestly, I haven't. So I put in a bid for 225. Is it right? No more than that. Bear in mind, it's like a movie cinema style poster, but it is just a poster. But it's where it came from means a lot to me. So as I put a bid in for 225, it goes to 250, so automatically my bid's now 275, and then I win it.
Well,
and then I'm like, oh my god, have I just spent £275 in a poster? But it wasn't that, because on top of the fees and the tax and the shipping and the FedEx, everything, that poster cost me £425.
Fuck.
But it came from Richard Edlund's personal collection, and being a fucking big fanboy geek for the effects in the first movie, it was like, okay, that's kind of cool. So I regretted it for a wee bit, then I got over it, and now it's like, I'm glad I've got it. I've nowhere to put it. I've no room. It's sitting in a fucking cardboard tube, safely wrapped up. One day I'm going to have space for it. I'm going to get it framed with the AOC to prove it's legitimate. It's going to be on display because it came from someone who worked in the movie. If the house is on fire, that's coming in the first. I've also got a few other little props, like one of the Stay Puft burnt heads from the first movie. I've got a piece of that in a display case. I've got a few other things from the second movie, but that poster might be like my grail just now.
Mm.
So if the house goes up in flames, that's coming first. But Nell, you are a nasty woman. That's a horrible question to ask me. A great question.
Mine's less excited. I would take the European belt, mainly because I love it, and I've got it signed by like Hurricane and DDP, yeah. And I carry it to shows, and it's sentimental. it's weird. I won it on eBay for 120 quid, and I just find it a nice sentimental thing for going to shows with. Even though I stopped doing that because you know, fucking nerd as it is, I've got a website about wrestling. I might take a belt to a show. That's too far. Sometimes
I loved hearing about your belt stories on the TNT pod.
Oh, we go through Elgin, fucking wearing it around my waist.
The fucking city. Okay, I'll be honest, right? When I did my backyard wrestling days, I bought a replica of the big gold belt and I went to the shops wearing it.
Oh, that's...
I went to the shops wearing it until eventually people told me, go and just fucking stop there. I was like 17 at the time, and I thought, oh, I've got a proper belt from Wrestling Inc. Is it Wrestling Inc. the company was? It was an American company.
Sounds right, yeah.
Yeah, and you just sent like the books every couple of months and stuff because I bought the belt from them. Walking down the shops wearing the belt, oh, look how cool I am. No, people are going to fucking stab you.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, still, if a European champion, former European champion, comes to an Aberdeen show, I'm still going to take that belt with me. That is happening. But generally, I've stopped putting it around my waist. If that's any, that's it just goes around the shoulder. That's how I wear a belt.
No, what you do is get yourself a proper belt bag, zip it up when it's done, put it in your backpack or whatever. Only take it when you
Yeah. I did that for the Hurricane one. The picture that popped up today in my memories. I remember I got the picture with Hurricane. I folded it back up. I put it back in my wee backpack. That was it. It was gone for the rest of the evening. Went back into my car, which was probably quite brave. But I put it into my car, and that was it. And then I had a wee niggling thing in the back of my head the whole show, going, "Some fucker better not steal that from my car." Shit! Someone might steal it from my car. I'm going to have to miss Bull James's entrance for me to go check that. Right, so...
Wow! Bull James.
Bull James. we got Murphy. Actually, no, we'll go Deacon Matthews. Deacon Matthews asks, if you are WrestleZone's Venkman, who makes up the rest of Ghostbusters, including Lewis and Slimer?
See, I don't think I am Venkman, because when Caleb asked this question, I never put myself as one of the Ghostbusters. So, I mean, I did the original lineup I had was Alan Sterling was Venkman, Caden Garrick was Winston, James Chester, referee / commentator extraordinaire, was Ray Stantz, and Egon was Reece Dawkins. Caden's kind of gone now, so I may get someone to fill that spot. But I'm happy with that. But Lewis and Slimer's new. So Slimer's Lord Mr. Malice. He's a bit of a pig anyway, so that works fine.
Fair.
Lewis, in terms of someone who looks like a Lewis Tully, Dennis Law could be Lewis Tully. But a part of me would want to pick Lewis Turner, ironically also called Lewis, because Lewis Turner is a big Rick Moranis fan, and he'd probably get a kick out of me picking Lewis to be Lewis Tully, despite the fact Lewis Turner is much larger than Lewis Tully would be. So Dennis Law, realistically, but just to top myself, is Lewis Turner can be Lewis. But Lewis and Slimer being involved. But thank you, Deacon, for changing it up. I appreciate that. Thank you.
So last one about Ghostbusters I've got here is from Murphy. Okay. He's asked, you're given the option to write and direct your own Ghostbusters film, TV show, cartoon, etc. Only condition is it must be a sequel to the 2016 film. Do you accept the position?
First of all, that question is fucking phenomenal, so well done, Murphy. Second of all, the answer is absolutely yes, because what I would do is I would take the IDW comic Crossing Over, where what happened was every incarnation of the Ghostbusters team would interact. So you had versions from the video games, you had the real Ghostbusters, you had the male Busters, you had the female Busters, you had extreme Ghostbusters, and at various points, they all cross dimensions and they all end up working together. That as a cartoon, where there's like a multiverse of every version of the Ghostbusters, would genuinely be fucking amazing. So I would do that in a heartbeat, because I would love to do that, because I think that comic needs to be turned into a cartoon, because it would be really fucking good. Because the comic, that comic, I'm not a comic guy, but I've got all the Ghostbusters, I've got most of them now, because of Ghostbusters. Some of them are genuinely brilliant. So every version of the team working together would be amazing. So the answer for that is 100% yes. All over that.
Speaking of like multiverse stuff, would that include like the toy lines and stuff like that when you get the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles
absolutely. There's so much of the toy ghosts that weren't actually part of the cartoon. They were just things they made just to make fucking money, but they would really be good in a cartoon setting. So, like Bug Eye Ghost and Pearson Flush and Granny Gross, and I could go on all day about it. I've got half of them all behind me here. Because I mean, like in Afterlife, one of the toys in Afterlife appeared in the background for like a split second. The Bug Eye Ghost came out, and it was like huge pop. I'm sitting in the cinema waiting for it to happen, and just for 1 second, here comes Bug Eye, and I'm just like, that's fucking amazing. So, I'm easily pleased, Billy. I'm very easily pleased.
That's fine. How do you feel about the your little figure of you in the background that I've got here?
I did notice that. Yeah, I actually do have it. I do have it. I've got one sitting on top of a Lex Luger pop, and in between it is the Flipping Grip Bret Hart and Lex Luger, where they got the
bag. Yeah.
Because I just fucking love Luger and I love Bret, so that'd be done. I saw it for £20 on eBay. It's like bought. So he's there, and I've got a Bo Nakano figure, because she never ever had a figure. So it's how I posted a Bo Nakano, and she was fucking brilliant. Mm-hmm. It's like, I'm having that. I'm not big into my wrestling collection just now, but I saw they were doing a Bo Nakano. It was like, all in for that. So yeah, he's kicking about there as well. Yeah,
I went back and looked at our previous episodes, and my collections of pops have gotten a lot bigger, but unfortunately they're in this corner because it was behind me, but I've got shit ton of baby stuff here, so I had to kind of pick and choose what I could have behind me. So the belt's one, because that's a pull out bed, so that was the easiest thing I could take off the bed to pull it out if I needed it, because it's pay-per-view night, so Kelly does not appreciate me rolling in at 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah,
just to go, oh, the wrestling was good. And she goes, I don't give a fuck. I want to sleep for another couple hours.
Exactly. That's fair. That's totally fair. That's
yeah. Totally fair. Right. So we've got anonymous question for Scotty Swift. So I can't reveal. Okay, I can't reveal who sent this to us.
Oh, away you go. Okay.
My Rushmore of nicest guys in Scottish wrestling.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Question as well.
Yeah. I'm going to mention one guy who isn't Scottish, but I'm going to cheat and include him. One's Bingo Balance. I know he's Irish, right? But he doesn't really wrestle anymore. He's kind of over it. But he makes an exception for us.
Mm-hmm.
I love Bingo. He's a lovely guy.
What do you think of his like really, his obsession on Wrestling Daft of Bingo Balance? I loved it. I thought that was hilarious.
I got a message from one of the guys that runs it, and it said, "Oh, a message on Twitter, a DM one day. It's like, oh, we're looking for Bingo Balance. It's like, oh, can you help? It's like, yes, I can.
Yeah, I sent them to you because I thought if anyone knows, it'll be you. So.
Fine. I love it. I actually listen to that one because I fucking love Bingo. He's great. Bingo Ballas was a guy who, when WrestleZone was still going, kind of still going into Cody, and we did a show in High Valley Field, July 2009. That's a rough area. A really rough area. Yeah, people were throwing stones at our cars. It was great. Is this just good? The show hadn't happened yet. They were just throwing stones at our cars. But Bingo worked that show. Can't remember who he was working. But we all kind of like, oh, we like him. He's sound as fuck and he's good. So always kind of said, if we ever were to take over, Bingo's a guy, we like him. I know he lives in Ireland, it's not convenient, but we just like the guy. We really like the guy. And because he was different, because he's more of a flyer and stuff. So it's 2009, so he's kind of semi-regular from that point. Bingo's one. Lord Michael Graham is legitimately, actually, like, he is the nicest person I've ever met. I say to him often, and either the guys will say to him, it's like, you're too nice for wrestling, get out while you can. Because you're too good for it. You're too good for it. He's the only person I can genuinely say that every single person loved him. Everyone. I mean, you get people, oh, I don't mind him, he's okay. It's a bit like across the board, love. Which is why, despite struggling with things and not picking up things, we all turned a blind eye to certain things to allow him to do something on a show, because we just wanted to make him fucking happy.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing guy. Number three is Dennis Law. I know you hate Dennis Law, but he's a lovely guy. He's lovely.
Again, I know. We have put out there that we don't hate Dennis Law.
I know.
But for everyone listening, for 3 hours. Once a month, Dennis Law is the worst human being in the world.
Dennis Law is absolutely, definitely one of the nicest people. Again, like another one, like, I don't know why he's hanging about with us. He's too good for us. He's too good for us. God, so that's three. So a fourth one.
While you're thinking about that, I'll give you a wee story about Dennis as well. Okay. So while you're thinking about that, when I put up a tweet about like struggling or something like that at one point, that was when I found out about my mom's cancer, and I think you messaged me to ask if I was okay, and I didn't really talk about. I pretty much said I'm okay. I've just got a couple things going on. Dennis messaged me every couple of days, kept checking in on me, and then I eventually told him that what was happening, and he just kept checking in. Caleb did the same. To put him in there as well. They kept tabs on me, it seemed, every so often, just to make sure everything was going all right. So I'm absolutely on board having Dennis Law on that Mount Rushmore of things, because nobody needs to do this kind of thing. No one needs to check on in a manner. I appreciated yourself. I think Lucha DS is our one that checked in on me as well. So I appreciate when people do that, because you don't need to. And the fact that Caleb and Dennis especially, they kept tabs on me, just checking in every so often. Caleb's still doing it, because now that I'm going to be a dad, he's checking in on me every so often just to make sure that everything's going well, and it just speaks to their character that they're just bloody nice people.
You know, I would definitely, I could say that I could close with Caleb on that Mount Rushmore as well, just for what you're saying there. Again, it's funny, like Caleb's like here's this big Viking looking guy. It's like this big scary wrestler, sweetheart.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And the guys like that as well, the guys like that don't need to act tough. Because you know, he's played pretty fucking handy, but he doesn't need to go on about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, it's the people that go on about being tough guys, the ones that aren't. You know, like, the guys who are, you know, no, like, the big scary guys are generally the guys who are nicest. Yeah. Also, again, and it totally kills the character, but Christian Crane was a lovely guy.
I can attest that as well. I had it's not on my question list, but throw out a favourite Crusher moment as well. Oh, actually, no, we need one more guy in the Mount Rushmore first before we move on.
I don't know. I mean, you know, I don't just arbitrarily just throw someone up there. I want to. I have a thing, but I was thinking about that. With picking a crusher moment is hard because, again, it's like it was. Cause, I mean, like I've had some pretty like good little feuds with people and stories with people, but he's definitely one that's like. You know, it was like he was the ultimate bad guy, and then he wasn't, and then people started loving him, and then it was like whether it was by design or just kind of happened that way is like we were kind of both like traveling at the same kind of, we're both two good guys, and eventually we're gonna have to fight at some point. It was like kind of, and he said this, and he didn't want to make it seem like our deal was bigger than what it was. Because I don't like to compare ourselves to people who are fucking infinitely better than anything we could ever be. But he said to me one time, he's like, we are the Rock in Austin just now. And it's like, and I looked at him and he's like, yeah, but no, we are though. And it's like, yeah, I guess so. Yeah, I just get kind of funny about using people who are like legitimate superstars with a comparison. But like for our level and where we were, like in 2015 and 16, we were the Rock in Austin, the wrestling zone, I guess. And eventually we had the anarchy, and I wish it ended better than then, better than what it did. It's like we started life, and then we had the match of Summer Hill, and then I got scarred up, and my legs was all cut up the fuck. So it's like, so you're scarred, and I'm scarred. So every time I look down, I think about him. You know, it's like, you did that. Well, actually, it wasn't his fault. It was an accident, but you know, it happened to him, actually. Yeah, it's like, yeah, it's I wish I could go back to Anarchy 16 and change the finish of that. It's a shame because we did like what I thought was pretty special.
Mm-hmm.
It's the best.
I'll say it as well. I enjoyed it. I mean, we all knew something was wrong when what happened. I won't labor on it. Because it's something that's not a good thing to happen to anyone. But yeah, it was a very weird deflating end. Not a deflating end, I suppose, because, you know, the good guy still won in the end. Great. But yeah, it was a little bit like, oh, shit, that's something's went awry here.
Yeah, I couldn't celebrate the fact that I'd won, because that's just tone deaf.
Mm-hmm.
No, I couldn't. It doesn't matter. I am saying, no, real life is more important than, you know. And again, like our track record of bad things happening is pretty fucking good. It doesn't happen very often.
Mm-hmm.
Like really, I mean, that's like that's the most significant thing that's happened. And 9 out of 10 times, it wouldn't have done. But yeah. Favorite crusher moment was when he left Stalin Oil, because everyone was fucking, they were just dying to cheer him.
Mm-hmm.
And they were, it's the same thing, like his kind of ascent to turning was the same as Damien. They were fucking dying for it. And it was like, just wait, you're going to get it. You know, it'll be worth it. And then when his crusher won, he won a rumble 1 year and turned face off the back of it and stuff, and the place fucking exploded. It is good shit. Good shit.
I'll throw out my favorite crusher thing is always going to be his 2014 Anarchy build up, him and Jester. Sublime. Loved it. I loved the match. I loved everything about it. That was just, there was one of those stories that I always go back to, is just like every beat hit.
It was like, it was one of those, he turned babyface and rehumanized him to give him layers.
Mm-hmm.
Without making it seem like more than what it was. But that's what it was. I mean, we had to, to do something where Crusher became a three-dimensional character, and the kind of thing, you got like a Goldberg style character, and you can run with that for so long, but there needs to be some growth and depth of the character, and that's what Crusher needed to be. That, oh fuck, he's got a heart. He actually does have a heart. He does care. He's not just a monster. He's like, he actually does have feelings. It sounds really odd because of course he does, but with the character that they've created. And that's why, like, he was a constant since 2009, and he always found ways to change something. It's like Crusher loves Undertaker, and Undertaker always found a way to be relevant, and Crusher definitely was influenced by Taker. The way he worked and also the way that he'd reinvent himself and just, you know. And then even his last run with Connor, and he's almost like his dad. That's good shit. That's so good. I wish he did more with the Christmas Claus stuff.
Yeah.
Because I thought that was fucking hysterical. But I love bullshit. I love character stuff and the vignettes and doing stupid shit, and you know, let's go out tonight and film something that's really entertaining. And I was like, that final run was where he had the most fun, I think, because he didn't have to worry about being invincible. He could show vulnerability, and when you can show vulnerability, that's when you can have a bit more fun with your character. Because he'd done everything. And like, he left when he was still capable of doing, because I mean, like, that match at Anarchy was fucking awesome. And when he tagged in, he got that hot tag and the place exploded. Holy fuck. Like, no, I mean, like, what a way to go out with a packed crowd popping big for you. And then on the way out, you got Evans and Riley as tag champions. And everyone, and like, all you cunts were waiting for Crusher to kick Connor in the face, like, fuck yes.
I know Crusher did. I was speaking to him afterwards, and he was like, "You were just waiting for something." I was actually waiting for Connor to attack
that
Crusher.
That was an amazing roller coaster of emotion.
Yeah,
like just from.
It was just that moment of him just going, "Oh, we won't have a rematch." I'm like, "Oh, who's getting battered? Come on, who's getting battered?" And then it was and I was like, "Oh no, now I'm crying. This is not right. No." What's happened?
I had a moment. I was standing at the monitor, and I'm well aware that I'm surrounded by lots of men, so I'm just trying to hold it together, to be honest with you. And that's all. Right.
So we'll leave the fourth one to be decided. So we'll go for the Mount Rushmore with. We've got three of the four.
No, got Bingo. We got Lord Mr. Wallace. We've got
The Lord Michael Graham was the second one.
Lord Michael Graham.
And Dennis Law.
Sorry,
Malice. It's me. imagine Malice's face, 20 foot tall and rock. There's a vision for everyone.
No.
So we're two questions left. We're almost there. We're only 5 minutes over what I thought we were going to be finishing at. Omar Muhammad asked just to ask you about Swift faces. Eh?
This is a thing. It's like, it used to be Johnny faces. Like, Johnny would pull on these faces and then it would become like a thing. Like, Johnny faces a thing. And now Swift faces became a thing. So it's just, you know, just getting a picture and then like, just screenshotting it and zooming right in. There's quite a few faces from Anarchy where I'm just like reacting to Johnny coming in off the hot tag and bam bam bam. I haven't even spoken it, but the fact that Johnny came back for one more.
I know. The original thought of Afterlife was going to be we'd get Johnny to jump in, but it's his birthday this weekend, so I think that's a bit of a dick move. So hey Johnny, get in here. Johnny Lyons.
Well, I think part five. I'm sorry, it'll be part five. So this, no, not done here. But yeah, no, you know, this became a thing. So this, so Omar's now got like a face of me for every reaction. So just send, here we go, it's my face again, it's fine. So I'll start sending him faces. It's like me and my friend Lindsay have got this gimmick where he'll just send me a picture because like his dad's like started sort of going bald at a really young age. And Lindsay always wears bandanas and stuff, but he's now going bald, and he thinks it's funny because you shoot being bald, but he looks bad bald because he's had long hair for the whole time I've known him.
Right.
He'll send me pictures of himself where he purposely goes out of his way to look bad. Then I'll send it back. So now I'm sending Omar pictures of myself where I just look terrible on purpose, and it's just, to me, that's funny. I just think that's funny. So Swift faces is now a thing. Thank you, Omar.
And last question.
I know, way, my face. Hey.
The last question is the most important one. It's from Blue Thunder. It simply says, "Pint."
Aye, I'll take a pint for you. Aye, aye.
Excellent. I think we did all right there. We've rattled through the questions. Rattled through a good like amount of questions in about 40 minutes. I think we did all right there, considering we could have just taken every question for a good hour, probably, easily, in that time.
Well, I could have done. I mean, I didn't even speak about Johnny coming back for Anarchy. We've never spoken about the Academy. We always speak about talking about Academy.
We always forget the Academy. Every time we kind of finish up an episode and go, oh, we didn't speak about the Academy.
It's really good. The guys coming out of it are really good. I'm happy with it. Right, move on.
What would you call a fifth episode? There hasn't been, like, a fifth edition of Ghostbusters. It ruins the flow. Is it just Scotty Swift 5, the real Scotty Swift?
Maybe. I can think of something.
That's fine. Once you know this child, this impending child sleeps through the night, we'll get season 5 kind of up and running sometime next year,
Or we could always do like another match gimmick. No, just pick a match you want to watch and we can do it. I know you haven't done it with anyone else yet, I don't think, but I do think people would be open to you watching matches with them.
I had some nibbles. I had some nibbles of folk get interested, and it just hasn't really come to anything. So I'm hoping, like, that's a nice, easy thing for me to do because I don't need to actually do any research for it. So that would be a nice way to kind of just dip my toe back into it sometime towards the end of the year. So that could be a thing that we do. But yeah, we'll figure it out on our way, and we might finally speak about the Academy as well. So I think that's probably a good time to kind of, like I say, it's gonna be a part 5 sometime in the future, because I can't go through a season of this podcast without just getting a catch up. We only really stuck on the questions, and we didn't really go into anything too historic or anything in the past. It's just a 3-hour chat of just chatting with Scott Swift. That's just all it is.
Hey, Billy Strachan.
So I think with that, we'll just wrap up so I can get, because I've broken the seal, so I actually need to pay again. So we'll wrap up there. I don't know if you want to plug your socials. Are you quite, just where people find out about Scotty Swift?
It's gala season. That'll get updated in the rest of the Facebook page. The next big one is Battle Nations, August 16th at Summerhill Hotel. The main event is going to be a rematch from January, Zach Dynamite against Damien. It'll be fucking awesome because those two are two of the best guys in the fucking country, and I cannot buy for that fucking fact. I'm paying too much, but I don't fucking care. Tickets are available right now for Ringside World. General admission and VIP are on sale. I don't know what I'm doing yet. There's a very good possibility it'll be the match at Anarchy that didn't happen. I'd like to see Killer Valhalla against Alan Sterling. Now that Alan Sterling is over COVID, I would enjoy that. And I have no doubt the match will be fantastic. The show will be fantastic, and she'll be there.
I have my ticket. I might not be there. But we'll see how things go, because that's within 4 weeks. That's a bit dodgy at that time.
Don't give birth. I tell you, no chance. a terrible.
Imagine, like, you see me, like, having no fucking reaction most of the time at a show. Imagine that I'm sitting there, Kelly's near there, she's at home, me just sitting there going, oh, fuck. Oh, Jesus, hopefully, every so often, there'll be a picture, Brian will get a picture of me just checking my phone every so often just to make sure, is it still there? Is it still in? Is it still in? Is it still, is it still available? Is nothing happened? Are you okay? Are you okay? Are you okay? Are you okay? Yeah, but hopefully, fingers crossed, I'll be there. And get to see it. But no, this has been a two-year anniversary episode of the SWN podcast. We are about 50 minutes away from 50 minutes or so away from hitting 3 hours on this show. Which,
how the fuck has that happened?
How have we done this? We're probably close to about 7 to 8 hours of content, and we really haven't spoken about an awful lot in that time. It's ridiculous, but we're gonna call it time for this chapter of Scotty Swift, and season 5 we'll be back again with more stuff, I'm sure. So thank you for joining me for another chat.
If anyone has made it this far, in the words of Kyle, he said it before, if anyone's made it this far, God bless you, because holy fuck. Holy fuck.
That's the best way to end it.